Good morning, everyone. Welcome to the second meeting of the Net Zero Energy and Transport Committee for 2022, which we are conducting remotely this week. As agenda item one, we have consideration of whether to take agenda items 5 and 6 in private. Agenda item 5 is consideration of today's evidence, and agenda item 6 is consideration of our work programme. Do members agree? That is agreed. Items 5 and 6 will be taken in private. Our first item is the consideration of a statutory instrument on the Climate Change Nitrogen Balance Sheet Scotland Regulations 2022. I welcome Mary McCallum, Minister for Environment and Land Reform, joining us remotely. I also welcome officials Kirsten Beddoes, Head of Agriculture, Transformation for Environment and Climate Change, and Dr. Tom Russon, Head of Climate Change Legislation. Thank you for attending this session, everyone. This instrument is laid under the affirmative procedure, which means Parliament must approve it before it comes into force. Following this evidence session, the committee will be invited at the next agenda item to consider a motion to approve the instrument. I now invite the Minister to make a short opening statement. Minister, over to you. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Convener. Good morning, everyone, and I hope you can hear me. I'm very pleased to join you today to give evidence in support of draft regulations to establish Scotland's nitrogen balance sheet. Now, nitrogen is present right across our economy and environment. The benefits arising from it cannot be overstated, as nitrogen is essential for the production of food, on which I think we would agree we all depend, and many other processes. However, the harms associated with losses of nitrogen into the environment can be significant. These include contributions to climate change through greenhouse gas, impacts on human health through air quality pollutants, and impacts on biodiversity through excess nutrients entering terrestrial and aquatic ecosystems. All of this means that the efficient use of nitrogen is a very important matter with far-reaching consequences. And to give just one example, the efficient use of agricultural fertilisers helps to reduce wastage of nutrients, thereby minimising environmental harms and also realising economic benefits for those who produce our food. So the importance of understanding nitrogen use at a national scale was recognised by the Parliament during the 2019 Climate Change Bill process, with a commitment to develop that which we're here discussing today. This has been taken forward by the Scottish Government in a way that has provided key stakeholders across a range of sectors and interests with opportunities to input their views. And I would like to just take the opportunity to record my thanks to all those who have contributed and to the scientific experts who've supported what is a very technical and complex piece of work. In December, we published the full data set for the first version of the balance sheet, accompanied by a comprehensive report setting out key findings. And this draft SSI will, if agreed by your committee today, Convener, serve to formally establish the following key aspects in law. Firstly, we have prepared the balance sheet to be as broad in scope as is possible within the constraints of data availability. It covers not only the core engine of nitrogen use associated with food production, but also transport, industry, forestry and others. It also, very interestingly, not only looks at nitrogen flow within Scotland, but into and out of where that data has been available. So this broad scope allows for a truly economy-wide calculation to be undertaken of efficiency of nitrogen use in Scotland. And this term is defined in line with international scientific guidelines as meaning the ratio of nitrogen contained in useful output, such as foodstuffs, to the total input of nitrogen through both human and natural processes. But I like to think of it as being the deficit between what goes in and what comes out, although perhaps my officials will be cringing at that very simplistic thought process. Application of this calculation to the initial nitrogen balance sheet, that data sheet, which mainly relates to about 2019, leads to a 25% baseline figure for national nitrogen use efficiency. But I would emphasise that any single metric can only capture a very small part of what is a rich and complex landscape. But again, if members are interested in the detail of that, I would suggest reading the accompanying report, which is very interesting indeed. Very quickly, Convener, a second feature of our proposed approach is for the balance sheet to be reviewed and updated annually with associated reporting to Parliament. And this will support the ongoing development of the evidence base, as well as keeping track of progress in Scotland's nitrogen use efficiency. So we are, to our knowledge, the first country in the world to enshrine in law a nitrogen balance sheet that is both economy-wide and regularly updated. And I think this is, we would all agree, a further example of this Parliament's determination that Scotland should lead the way in the climate emergency. It will provide government with, and Parliament with, a powerful new tool to support evidence-based policy making, and that at the interface of several strategic areas. And that's something that I'm very interested in, the extent to which we have a balance sheet which shows us how climate change, air quality, water pollution coexist, that we can pull to make some of our policy objectives here. So put simply, striving towards the efficient use of nitrogen helps to ensure that economic, environmental and well-being outcomes can be achieved alongside one another. And having established the balance sheet, we've provided an innovative new evidence base to support this. It's a very early stage in the journey, rather than a final destination, which is why we have committed to maintain a review. I very much look forward to continuing to work with Parliament and others with an interest in nitrogen at that, as that work continues and as the balance sheet develops. And indeed, as we see other countries around the world, perhaps follow where Scotland's led, international comparators will arrive. But for now, I'll leave it there, Convener, and my officials and I would be very happy to answer any questions.
Thank you very much for your opening statement, Minister. If members do have questions, if you could indicate in the chat bar, and I see that some members have indeed indicated that they have questions for the Minister. I will start with Mark Ruskell, to be followed by Liam Kerr. Mark, over to you, please.
Thanks, Convener. And can I just welcome this? I mean, you know, this is a world first, and the previous committee spent a lot of time looking at the impact of nitrogen on climate change and air quality and water quality. So it's really great to see this coming through Climate Change Act and now actually coming into law. I wanted to ask, though, the Minister just about the application of this. I mean, you know, you said that it's early days, and it is a world-leading approach. But I'm just thinking about how this balance sheet and how the kind of action plan that will be associated with it, how that will be used by regional land use partnerships or through river basin management plans in practical management of nitrogen. I mean, in Scotland previously we've had nitrate vulnerable zones. There have been attempts to try and manage nitrogen in areas where we've got particular problems in terms of air pollution or water pollution. But how does this then provide a change in the way that, you know, practical land managers at a regional, local level can go about their work? How does it actually inform that work going forward and the options that are available?
Thanks, Mark. It's a really good point. And I would begin again by reiterating it is early days. It is complex. It will require review. And as that review continues, as the evidence is gathered, it will become a more useful policy development tool. In the meantime, however, what I think its primary use, and something which I am most excited about actually, is the extent to which it shows us how all of these areas that you have identified interact with one another. So if we think about the state of play just now, prior to having the balance sheet, we know that there are actions being taken right across government within the climate change plan update, for example, with regards to agricultural emissions, within Cleaner Air for Scotland 2 as regards air quality. So these actions are being taken in their individual areas. What the balance sheet will allow us to do in government and indeed external to government will allow us to see how those actions interact. And not only does that help what we're doing in the individual areas, but it also allows us to see, well, for example, what actions can we take which provide the most co-benefits across these strategic areas? So in terms of the trajectory, it's about having, you know, having established the balance sheet, allow it to develop with greater information, with more data. And then its use within government will be about complementing those actions that we're already taking across the piece. And I hope, additional to that, it will be a really important tool for analysis and suggestion of outputs outside of government by all the folk who we know are working very hard across all of these important areas.
Yeah, but if you're say involved in a regional land use partnership, so you've got all of those land managers and stakeholders together right now, what can you actually use this right now? I mean, could it help to inform decisions about, you know, what farmers are doing around, you know, riparian, you know, habitat management or nitrogen application on a catchment scale?
I think, yes, it's helpful. Can you take it down to that granular scale at this point? I would suggest probably not, particularly as regards that 25% baseline figure, because that is a high level figure. These are not regional level data sets. These are not farm level data sets. You know, that might be something which in time we would hope to develop. But right now, I think what we've established is a high level Scotland wide, economy wide picture from which developments will come.
Okay, thanks.
Thank you very much, Mark, for those questions. Let me bring in Liam Kerr to be followed by Fiona Hislop.
Yeah, thank you, Convener. Good morning, Minister. This does really strike me as welcome, but extraordinarily complex. So I just wonder if I might ask a couple of things to clear up in my own mind. Section 8A5 defines nitrogen use efficiency as meaning, you said, comparing what goes in to what comes out. And then Regulation 4 sets the baseline for this at 25%. Can you explain to me, what does that actually mean? 25% of what going in precisely where and coming out of precisely where? And why was 25% felt to be the right or the appropriate figure for the efficient use of nitrogen?
Thanks, Convener, and thanks, Mr. Kerr. Yeah, so you're asking the questions which I asked myself at the beginning of this process. So I said that my officials would be cringing at me describing it as, you know, what goes in and what doesn't come out. But that's how I like to think about the processes. And you can imagine how that would happen, for example, in food production, you know, the nitrogen that is put into the food production system. Not to be crude, but it's, you know, what's excreted essentially is how we calculate the deficit, as I have been calling it. As regards that 25% figure, that is essentially the baseline that's been calculated as where we might see we are across the board just now with the economy. So that will, and this is explained really nicely in the report, probably better than I can today, but how I understand it is that we have figures for nitrogen use efficiency across, let's say, food production, and we can break that down into livestock farming, into crop production. Now, I understand that the overall figure for nitrogen use efficiency in agriculture is 28%. So you can see that that national 25% figure is quite heavily dominated by the agricultural figure. But of course, because it's whole economy, we build in the figure for forestry, for waste, for industry. And that's what gets us to the 25%. So what, and I can bring in Dr. Russin as well, because he's far more into the detail of this than I am. But what that 25% figure represents is the state of play on average across the board within our economy just now. I'm not sure, hopefully that's helpful, but I'm happy to bring in my team as well if you'd like a little bit more of a scientific explanation on that.
It is helpful, Minister, and I'm very grateful to you. I wouldn't mind if one of your officials is there with an answer, but I did actually follow quite clearly what you said there, so I'm grateful for that. But yeah, let's hear from your official.
Tom?
Yeah, thank you. Good morning, committee. So, yeah, I mean, on the second element of the question about, yeah, what does the baseline represent, I wouldn't really have anything to add to how the Minister's expressed it very well. This is the state of play that the data, the best available data, kind of leads us to. On the first aspect of the question about unpacking a bit what those key outputs and inputs are that give you that 25%, I'm happy to spend as much time as the committee's patience will allow unpacking these things. There's a huge amount of detail in the published reports around these things. But as the Minister alluded to earlier, really the key outputs that are forming the top of that ratio calculation are predominantly to do with foodstuffs. They also include wool production, which contain nitrogen, and also forestry products, many of which contain significant amounts of nitrogen as well. Those are really the main kind of useful outputs coming out of the economy-wide calculation. The input side, which forms the bottom of that ratio, is in many ways more interesting in that that represents a combination of anthropogenic inputs. By far the largest one is the application of fertilizer for agriculture. But there are other things too, such as the amounts of nitrogen contained in fossil fuels that are combusted for the purpose of transport and industry and energy supply. But there are also purely natural processes that are adding nitrogen into the Scottish environment. There is nitrogen being deposited out of the air onto ecosystems, and there are processes such as biological nitrogen fixation, which is directly converting nitrogen from the air into part of plant material. And both of those, the anthropogenic and the natural processes, form part of those inputs into the system. So yeah, I think that kind of is just another way to look at that, the point the Minister is making, that it is, it's a very complicated system that's bringing together both human interventions and also purely natural processes. And it's, in thinking about that 25% baseline, it's really worth unpacking quite a bit of that and thinking about it very carefully. I'll stop there. Very happy to expand further if that would be helpful.
No, I'm very grateful to you both for that summary. Back to you, Convener.
Thank you very much. Liam, Fiona Hislop has a question to be followed by Jackie Dunbar. Fiona, over to you, please.
Thank you. That was a detailed question. I'm interested in the context. I wonder if the Minister can briefly expand on why nitrogen is so important and perhaps in relation to emissions of greenhouse gases generally, but I'm conscious of time, so a brief answer would be helpful.
Thanks, Ms. Hislop. Yeah, absolutely. So I think the first and foremost point is that nitrogen is one of the fundamental building blocks of life, meaning it's present everywhere. And as we've said, it's the vital underpinning of food production, which we all agree we need to eat. But what this balance sheet shows us is that it's not just food. So important for other economic processes like the production of natural fibre, as Tom was just referring to, and forestry materials. Whilst this means that some nitrogen in some situations can present very real challenges, including greenhouse gases, nitrous oxide, for example, and impacts on water quality, it can't always just be viewed as a problem. So we need to be prepared to take a nuanced approach to what this balance sheet tells us. And for example, nitrous oxide, as I mentioned, is a greenhouse gas, emissions of which we know contribute to climate change. So clearly whilst this is a helpful data set which demonstrates nitrogen across the economy and coming into and out of Scotland, what we need to be prepared to do is understand that nitrogen is ever present. It's not always a negative thing. We need to identify where it is and work on that. And I think it was in relation to Mark Ruskell's question, I mentioned that there is policy work, as you know, Ms. Hislop, which is happening right across government, most particularly through the Climate Change Plan update, which already seeks to pull all these levers to reduce the negative effects of nitrogen as a greenhouse gas.
Thank you, and back to you, Convener.
Thank you very much, Fiona. Jackie Dunbar has a question, and then the final question, it looks like, is going to come from Natalie Dawn. Jackie, over to you, please.
Thank you, Convener. This is really, really informative today, so can I thank you? It was just briefly to ask if the Minister can maybe explain the time frame for the immediate next steps for the balance sheet going forward.
Yeah, absolutely. Thanks, Ms. Dunbar. So if the committee are able to indicate your support for the draft SSI today, then we will be on track to fulfil the legislative requirements well in advance of the deadline of 23 March. And that was to have the initial version of the balance sheet formally established in law. That's what we'll do today. And then, as I've said in my opening remarks, the process will be annual review and updating to Parliament of the balance sheet moving forward, and that will begin from next year onwards.
Thank you very much. Back to you, convener.
Thank you very much, Jackie. And final question, I believe, is from Natalie Dawn. Natalie, over to you.
Thanks, convener. Yeah, I agree with my colleagues. This has been very informative today. Minister, I'm just wondering if you can clarify. We've touched on this already a little, but we understand that food production obviously lies at the heart of the balance sheet. But can you expand a little on some of the other areas that it covers as well?
Yeah, of course. Thank you, Ms. Dawn. So really important point, and I've tried to make it throughout, but just, I suppose, again, food production, it is at the heart of this because nitrogen's at the heart of food production, but it is not the only flow, and we've sought to reflect that in the balance sheet, which is categorically not just about agriculture and aquaculture. The balance sheet covers the use of nitrogen in forestry, as well as flows of nitrogen associated with fossil fuel combustion in sectors like transport, industry and energy supply. It also looks to waste management processes, which can serve to recycle nitrogen, taken in through human nutrition and back into parts of the wider system. So here we have a picture right across Scotland, and where data allows into and out of Scotland. It's a very broad scope approach. It is unique in the world, and I very much hope that other countries will follow where Scotland's led so that we can have that international comparator of how Scotland is efficiently using nitrogen as compared with our friends and neighbours across the world.
Thank you, that's very helpful.
Great. Thank you very much, Natalie, and thank you, Minister, for those answers. I believe there are no further questions from members, so we will move to Agenda Item 3. Agenda Item 3 is formal consideration of Motion 02578, calling for the Net Zero Energy and Transport Committee to recommend approval of the Climate Change Nitrogen Balance Sheet Scotland Regulations 2022. Only the Minister and members may speak in this debate. Do I therefore invite the Minister to speak or to simply move this motion?
I'll move the motion, convener. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Minister. Let me ask members, are there any final contributions or questions from members? There are no final questions or contributions. So the question is that motion 02578 in the name of the Minister for Environment and Land Reform be approved. Are we all agreed? We are agreed. The committee will therefore report on the outcome of this instrument in due course. I invite the committee to delegate authority to me as convener to approve a draft of the report for publication. And with that, let me thank the minister and the officials for joining the meeting today. Thank you very much. I will suspend the meeting briefly for the setup of the next panel. Thank you, Minister. For our next item, we welcome our second set of witnesses for our inquiry into the role of local government and its cross-sector partners in financing and delivering a net zero Scotland. We are hearing today from representatives of sustainable development within the public sector and also from community groups. The first panel today comprises representatives from the Sustainable Scotland Network, and I'm pleased to welcome George Tarvett, Director of Sustainable Scotland Network, John Wincott, Chair of Sustainable Scotland Network and also Environmental Services Coordinator at Fife College, Mark Williams, Vice Chair of Sustainable Scotland Network and Head of Sustainability and Climate Change at Scottish Water, and Lorna Jarvie, Steering Group Member at Sustainable Scotland Network and Coordinator Sustainability and Fleet at South Ayrshire Council. Thank you all for accepting our invite this morning and for joining this panel. It is very good to see you. We have just over an hour for this panel, and I believe that Mr. Wincott will briefly introduce the Sustainable Scotland Network. All questions should then be directed to him in the first instance, and he will nominate one of his co-panelists to answer questions from members. Mr. Wincott, I will hand over to you for a brief opening statement. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Convener, and thank you very much for inviting us here today. We really appreciate the opportunity. First of all, I'd just like to apologise for not having any advanced papers available for the committee. The invitation unfortunately arrived on Christmas Eve and our staff were already away. So we did try and get some papers in later, but I believe there have been problems with the email system as well at the Scottish Government, none of which has helped us. But so apologies for that. Really, I just want to briefly introduce SSM because I'm not sure exactly how much the panellists or the committee understand what SSM really does. It's been said that if we didn't exist, you would need to invent us. And I think that's more important as we progress with this climate emergency. I like to compare our function, for instance, with the CCC. I tend to regard the CCC as very much a critical friend. And in that regard, we're different. SSN, I regard as a delivery partner, working with the government and with Parliament to try and deliver on the climate emergency and the climate change mitigation goals. SSN is made up of practitioners, people who work at the coalface. You can see from the panellists today, we're all actually active in working in the climate change sphere. And if you look at the last 6 months, we've been heavily involved working with the Scottish Government on producing the guidance, the public sector leadership climate emergency guidance that was released late last year. And as an indication of the type of people we use or we have as members in that, the membership for that piece of work was selected from our steering group panel and included people from Scottish Water, Nature Scot, local authorities, colleges, the NHS, universities, obviously the SSN Secretariat and Scottish Government officials. Then on December the 8th, we had our post-COP conference, which was titled COP26, What Next? And we used that conference to launch the guidance into our membership. We had around about 200 people attending that. So we launched the guidance, explained how it would work, and also use workshops to try and start to address the challenges that people were facing when it comes to the challenges that we face on climate change. We also work very strongly with the government on the public body climate change duties reporting. So in that area, we provide support, we provide resources, and we provide analysis. The analysis we think is particularly important because when public bodies submit these reports, they are very detailed spreadsheets. And what SSN does is pull key data out from that. So for instance, in our 1920 analysis, the public bodies reduced emissions between 2015-16 and 2019-20 by 28%, which was no mean feat. Local authorities that on their own reduced emissions by 10.7% between 2017-18 and 2019-20. And also local authorities saved over 54,000 tonnes of CO2 equivalent in 2019-2020. With projects that they implemented then. And of course, SSN is also heavily involved in addressing the challenges that we're all facing regarding climate change mitigation. The challenges are often labelled skills, food delivery and finance. And clearly these are major challenges going forwards. What SSN provides is an atmosphere of collaboration, support and trust. I've underlined trust in my notes because trust is so important in the acceleration of delivery that we're all facing now. And I noticed one of the panelists last week was saying that, you know, we need to be able to make mistakes. And we do, because we're working in a very difficult environment and learning as we go. And the trust element that SSN brings with our members and steering group means that we can talk about things that haven't gone well and stop other people making the same mistakes. And we deliver these by providing rules, tools and training. Rules you can see from the guidance that we've produced with the Scottish Government. Tools behind that are we're producing a manual at the moment that will be delivered to our members to enable them to use the guidance better. And training will be sharing best practice. And we deliver these by bringing a breadth of perspective, experience and maturity from the membership that we have in SSN. And all our members effectively provide contribution in kind by virtue of the time they devote to our efforts. And finally, we will try and keep our answers brief. I'm going to wind up shortly. And we will follow up with written supplementary information should that be necessary. So thank you again very much for giving us the time today.
Thank you very much, John, for that opening statement. And it's a pleasure to have you and your colleagues in front of the committee. We'll now move on to questions, and let me begin with the first question, because during the previous two meetings of this committee, we heard from the UK Climate Change Committee, which you mentioned, and from a range of local authorities. The evidence given during those sessions highlighted concern over a lack of strategic consultation between the Scottish Government and local authorities and partners in relation to net zero implementation, a lack of detailed policy guidance, and called into question whether the 2030 targets for the heat and building strategy were achievable. Do you agree with those concerns? And what do you see as the main challenges faced by your members in reaching net zero targets across the different sectors that you represent?
I think one always has to agree with concerns expressed by the CCC. They are experts and they provide a tremendous amount of analysis and detail. And if they're expressing concerns, I think we have to take really strong cognizance of that. I think that we are all aware of the tremendous challenge that we face. This is not easy. Achieving the target for 2030 and the ongoing target of 2045 is going to take a huge amount of effort. We like to think that the guidance that has been released late last year will provide a lot more help and assistance for all public bodies. So it, for the first time, really starts to break down in detail what people are aiming to achieve. But then beyond that, there will be statutory guidance produced, I believe, this year by government officials and obviously through Parliament. And we will be producing the manual and the much more detailed approaches that can be used. But yeah, I mean, to be honest, Convener, I think we're all concerned. The changes that we're facing and the efforts and challenges that we'll be facing us, both technically and also socially, are tremendous. So I think anybody who isn't concerned maybe doesn't understand the problem.
Yeah, you make a fair point, John. Thank you very much. The other common theme emerging from the evidence sessions we had with the local authorities was that they don't expect the Scottish Government to finance the transition to net zero at a local government or a local authority level. They make the point that the vast majority of funding will have to come from the private sector. Do you agree with this approach, or do you agree with this statement? And if so, what concrete steps are being taken by your organisation and the partners and members you work with? What steps are being taken to leverage in private sector funding? Are we just at the beginning of this process, or are you seeing good examples of public-private partnership where some of that private sector funding will start to feed into the transition?
Again, I think it is early days for the leveraging of private funding. I mean, the thing to bear in mind, as I said in the introduction, is SSN is all public bodies in Scotland. So although local authorities, I know, are the focus of this investigation by the committee, what we are bringing primarily is this collaboration, this working better together as public bodies across the piece. And I think funding is an element of that as well. At the moment, funding is very much obviously given to each public body. And it could be that there are opportunities for better funding change, where funding that's in one body's bank account, if you like, could be better spent by sharing the opportunities with another public body. But certainly SSN is always open to talking to the private sector, and we do have private sector companies and organisations that we're talking to. However, it is very early days for certain. But again, I'm sure we recognise that the Scottish Government is not going to be in a position to fund all of the change that's necessary.
And just a brief follow-up on that, presumably amongst your member organisations there will be a high number of public sector buildings that will have to be converted to meet the heat and buildings strategy by 2030. Aside from the actual, you know, channelling of private sector finance, has work started in terms of identifying the number of buildings that have to be converted and how, you know, how that might work across different local authority areas? You mentioned that, you know, that some of the buildings and some of the projects would best be served if they were across local government areas. I just wondered if work has begun in terms of that initial step of identifying the buildings that will have to be converted to meet the 2030 targets?
Absolutely. And I mean, it varies across the piece. So some local authorities are more advanced than others. Some colleges are more advanced than others. NHS has done a really excellent piece of work on looking at their buildings. But I mean, I must say that the recent release of funding, the originally announced 95 million, which was then increased to 200 million in grants for primarily colleges and the NHS, has been a big boost to our efforts, especially the fact that it provided pre-capital funding, if you like, pre-capital spend, which has enabled, for instance, Fife College, where I, you know, people who pay my wages and my day job, to start looking at how we can put together projects now that we weren't able to look at before. So some of this seed corn funding, if you want to call it that, where we can start looking at projects and getting, to use the term, shovel-ready projects available so that when funding becomes available, we are ready to go. I think that's good. But I mean, let's not pretend that the building situation is easy, because it really isn't. I mean, just on my estate alone, one of my campuses has got a mix of old and new building. The old building, we've only just managed to replace single glazed aluminium frame windows with double glazing, and it's gas-fired boilers. So if we're going to take out those gas-fired boilers and put in something else, there's going to be a massive insulation program required on the basic fabric of that building. Or are we going to look at things like hydrogen instead? And if we're going to look at hydrogen, What are the plans for hydrogen long term? When will it appear in Kirkcaldy, where that campus is? Or are we looking at other technologies that are perhaps in their infancy at the moment? So, you know, buildings is a huge program, but everybody I talk to is really heavily engaged in buildings, but everybody is looking at it as a serious challenge for certain.
Thank you very much, John. You've touched on some issues that other members will want to pursue. So let me bring in Fiona Hislop. Fiona, over to you.
Thank you, and thank you for joining us. I want to talk about conservation designation areas and ask the panel about the challenges for buildings there, particularly around glazing insulation options and potential restrictions. I also know, though, that Historic Environment Scotland have been very active in this, with innovations working with Edinburgh City Council. So do you think that a balance can be struck between historic urban environments and celebration and also preservation of those, as well as future-proofing them for climate change? And we know that there's been a very successful conservation area regeneration scheme across Scotland. Is there anything like a conservation area climate change scheme that would enable us to tackle conservation areas in particular? But I'd be interested in your views there, and if you can direct who might be most appropriate to answer that.
Thank you, yes. I mean, just by introduction, I mean, you've hit a nail on the head there with a really difficult challenge. And I think this is one of those areas where the Scottish Government does have some of the levers that are really important. So, for instance, I've seen planning applications being submitted to change buildings from single glazed wooden frame to double glazed with plastic frames that look identical, but the frames are rejected because they're not the same as wood. They're plastic. And so, whether you say that you should conserve the original material, which may not be the most suitable for climate change purposes, or whether you say you should conserve the original look, I think is a really interesting question. And I think that's probably a decision that the Scottish Government, working with Historic Environment Scotland, could potentially look at. What are the best solutions for this, which provide a good answer regarding climate change mitigation and carbon reduction, but also don't detract from the historic nature of the building? I don't know if any of my colleagues want to add to that. I'm not seeing any waving hands, so I may be it.
Is there anybody else wanting to come in on that? Okay. So I know because of my previous experience as a minister, there is work on this. I suppose we need to find out more from local authorities why it hasn't been as rolled out as much as it could be. Okay, I'll move on to my next area is actually completely different.
I see George wanted to come in. He was just slow with his button. So
George.
Yep. Just a very, very quick point, just to emphasise the fact that the SSN is Pan Public Sector, so Historic Environment Scotland has been a very active SSN member over the years, so we probably work with them, and it probably lends itself to the work that the SSN does in terms of local place collaboration, recognising that these are significant challenges. There's probably a need for a shift in terms of how local authorities address these issues in terms of planning regulations, etc. But our role would be very much bringing our members together to say, how do we tackle the problem together? So it was really just to point out the fact that Historic Environment Scotland has been a very active SSM member over the years, so we've worked with them to get the right advice.
Thank you very much, and partnership is the theme of the inquiry. So if I can maybe move on then to the area of water, and I know that you talked about in your route map about innovative partnerships and with local authorities and public sector agencies, and I'd be particularly interested in the area and work with Scottish Water in particular, if your members could comment. And some of the challenges about working together. So, for example, on flood prevention, there's been some very, very good work between local authorities and Scottish Water and Scottish Canals, actually. But I know from Scottish Canals' perspective, more can be done with West Lothian and Edinburgh, for example, councils in helping prevent work there. So if you can maybe comment on some of the opportunities there, and also, because I know we're limited time, if you also want to address any issues around rivers and Scotland's waterways. We know from the Environmental Audit Committee in England about concerns around levels of pollution. And again, the Scottish Waters Net Zero route map, for example, might be able to be helpful in this. So again, views on partnership working, but in water, the area of water in particular, would be interested to hear your views.
Thank you. Absolutely. All right. Thank you. That's a really good, a very broad question, if I may say so. I'm sure I'll pass over to Mark shortly, and he'll keep it as brief as he can. But an excellent question. Rivers, especially, I think, and the pollution of rivers is very much a hot topic at the moment. But Mark, would you like to comment on that, please?
Yes, I'd be delighted to. So first of all, the key point that you raised there was about the partnerships, and that's been a theme of the last couple of questions. And from my perspective, we can't deliver net zero as a single organisation, any of us. It's really about the partnerships to help to deliver the on-the-ground improvements that we need to see, so the geographic scale that we can deliver net zero on. When we look at these sorts of partnerships, you look at, for example, the things that we've had to do over the years in Glasgow around things like the Metropolitan Glasgow Drainage Programme, that recognised that we can't, as Scottish Water, address all of the drainage issues within Glasgow. We need all the multiple local authorities, roads authorities, and developers and various other partners around that table to help us to make the strategic choices that that enable Glasgow to sustainably drain its infrastructure in the future. But out of that also comes things like Clyde Gateway and the opportunity to bring in things like district heat into that sort of an approach. So getting these partners together is really key to unlocking the both the finance in terms of the investment required to deliver this, but also joining together the sources of heat, the recipients of heat, and enabling the projects to actually work appropriately. And the Scottish Water, we've obviously been open to those sorts of partnerships, so whether it's in the Stirling District Heating Programmes or the Advanced Manufacturing Innovation District that's developing around southern parts of Glasgow, around the airport area. So from my perspective, the partnership is really key both to deliver the issues and the investments required that was referenced earlier on. But from a water perspective, more generally, I'm really keen that we see water more reflected in the goals of net zero. So the use of water in the home, how we heat water, how we drain our infrastructure. We bring together both climate adaptation and mitigation together when we start to look at it at that sort of scale. So as Scottish Water, we will be actively and are actively seeking partnerships and working with local authorities, both on the drainage side and in looking at how we use water in the urban and environment and so on. When we look more broadly, the other area that partnership is really key is in the landscapes that we operate within, and in terms of what we can do to improve the natural capital of Scotland, to improve the ability of Scotland's landscapes to lock up carbon, and to obviously then improve the water quality and management of water and natural resources. So Scottish Water, again, is about partnerships. So the partnerships that that we're building with Forestry and Land Scotland around some of the lands that they lease from us, around Loch Katrine, looking at how we work with them on the land management plans to support the delivery of improved carbon capture, improved quality, improved biodiversity into that environment. So throughout the entirety of net zero, it's got to be about partnerships, how we as public bodies work together to, first of all, understand the issues, because it is complex, as was mentioned earlier on, and also to find those solutions to build the capacity to deliver that, both in terms of the investment, but also the skills and the capabilities. So I say, I realise that's a very high level kind of walk through a number of different issues there, but I'm happy to take any further questions.
I can maybe ask you, Mark, just what challenges there are in this and these, and what is the, what would enable this to happen better, basically?
Well, I think that we've got some good examples. We've got to see how we can move them at scale now, to scale them up to deliver more around these different areas. So, you know, I've mentioned kind of the advanced manufacturing site in Glasgow. I'm not particularly close to it, but it's something that I look at. I think, well, that's a great example of bringing multiple partners together to start the flywheel going, to start that generation of ideas and investment and capacity building to deliver more. So from my perspective, I think the making the connections, looking at, I suppose, national and local and regional planning and seeing how we can actually join this up even more. I mean, I was speaking a fair bit recently with Lewis Barlow at the Scottish Government, who is looking into and driving the carbon agenda for the city, region and regional growth deals, and looking at how we build that carbon thinking into that, those initiatives from the government and from local government, is really one of those key opportunities for us to, one, understand the problem, two, understand where carbon is, and then three, to then join the partners together to look at how we leverage that investment, leverage those opportunities to deliver low carbon infrastructure going forward. So I think from my perspective, it's about starting to kind of just generate more activity, generate that flywheel going a bit further, so we can start to see this spring up all over Scotland. You know, look at what works well in the existing partnerships. Why have we been able to deliver some of these things around Stirling, around you know, the Aqualibrium project working at Campbelltown, for example, using heat from sewers to support the heat in the leisure centre there? It's about how we look at those opportunities and the partners. What works well? How do we learn from those? How do we apply it further? So I think there's some great examples there we just got to get more recognition of. And you mentioned there the smart canals, or the, you know, Scottish canals, looking at how we can integrate infrastructure to support the collective outcomes. It's not easy, and it takes time and it takes effort to engage and build those networks. But those are the sort of, that's the sort of thinking that we need to have across Scotland to drive the net zero agenda.
That's very interesting, Mark. Thank you. Chair John, have you got anybody else you want to bring in on water before I hand back to the convener? Is there anybody else that wants to come in on that?
Okay. No, I think I covered it really well. Thank you.
Thank you. I'll hand back to Dean Locker at the convener.
Thank you very much. Fiona, let me bring in Monica Lennon. She'll be followed by Liam Kerr. Monica, over to you, please.
Thank you, convener, and good morning to all of our panel today. My interest today is waste management and the role of public bodies in Scotland's journey to a fully circular economy. So how do public procurement practices need to develop to achieve a circular economy? How well is this work being coordinated across the public sector? Where is innovation happening? And what do you see as being the main challenges?
Thank you. A huge question again. Somebody should have warned that this committee has big questions. I mean, circular economy, I mean, where do you begin? I listened to last week's presentations, and there was a lot mentioned there about the original, you know, the start of it all, consumption. What are we buying, and how easy is it to buy products that are circular economy products? I mean, just on a personal level, I've bought things which are refillable, And then when I try and refill them, the shop I bought them from doesn't sell the refill. I have to order it by mail, which costs me £2 more than the original product. So that's not a refillable product. I'm not, you know, nobody's going to spend £2 more for the refill than they did for the original. It's just, you know, once you've got, if you've got tiny things like that causing the issues, how a big organization is going to move on. But you're right to tackle, look at procurement, the public pound, how can we leverage that? Because obviously if public bodies are, if you like, initiating better thinking from suppliers, those suppliers will then roll that out to their other customers. So we can start to use our spending to say to suppliers, look, we want reusable, we want minimum materials, we want no packaging, all of these things. And then that means that they'll adopt those practices across the broader piece as well. So I think it's a really good point of how we use procurement to drive that forwards. I think waste, huge challenge. I know the target for zero waste to landfill was pushed back because of the challenges around being ready for that. And I know there's a lot of talk about whether energy from waste is really a better way of waste disposal. Clearly, it's better than putting it in a landfill. But how sustainable is energy from waste? So there are a lot of questions around that. That, again, I think looking at what SSN can bring, if it's determined that waste is a key factor for public bodies in general, then SSN then starts working on that, looking at that as part of the guidance that we've already produced, part of delivering the manual behind that, and looking at workshopping. To be honest, nobody around the table at SSN has all the answers. That's why we exist. However, when you put us all together, we're much bigger than the sum of our parts. And I think that is where the strength lies. I don't know, do any of my colleagues want to come in? Laura,
so before you do that, can I just come back in quickly? Because I think we are hearing lots of examples across public sector of good practice, but one of the frustrations is that that isn't scaled up. So I suppose thinking about that innovation question, because there will be some really good stuff, so how do we unlock the opportunity to scale that up? So maybe your colleague can maybe pick up the innovation part of the question.
Yeah, I think so. And I think that what I was saying about workshops and sharing best practice, it's a matter of time, to be honest. I mean, SSN Secretariat is a very small team. And although the as I say, the steering group and the membership provide a lot of contribution in kind, there's a finite amount of priorities that we can address. If waste becomes the priority for SSN, then we will workshop that and share best practice and innovate. But sorry, Lorna, I was just going to invite you in there because I know you've got experiences around that potentially in your local authority as well.
Yeah, thank you, John, and thank you for the opportunity to speak to you this morning. I think when it comes to circular economy and procurement, within my own local authority, but within as well, I think we are trying to work with procurement colleagues, but also with colleagues across local authorities, because one of the things that's easy to sometimes forget is that procurement takes place right across the local authority staff complement. So even looking at issues as we have in our local authority around single-use plastics, the challenge isn't about working that through with a small group of staff, it's often about working that through with the entire procuring staff body, which is vast and scattered across many different services. So it's a difficult challenge and you have to take a lot of people with you. So it does come back to a lot of the things that we spoke about early on, about communication, about dialogue, about everybody understanding the big vision of where we're trying to take this. I think that links to the climate literacy agenda, which we have to scale up to be able to really tackle the size of this problem. Because it's really important, I think, in our organisations, whether it's the local authorities we work with, the other public bodies we work with in SSN, that vision of where we're trying to get to with this agenda is clear for everybody and that we can understand our role within that. No matter what service of a local authority we're in, what level of officer we are, we all have to recognise the part we can play. And I think that goes for the work we've been doing regionally as well. We've been trying to do work across the region I'm from, across the Ayrshire region, and that came out of a question asked at our community planning partnership about what is it that we need to do to help fulfil this vision of net zero for Scotland? What's our part to play in this? And I think it's the same question when we come to procurement circular economy. I think to be successful, all of the players, and there are many, need to be clear about what part in this are we playing. Is it the dialogue that we might be having with suppliers quite far down the supply chain that's going to unlock this? Is it just for an officer, what they buy on that particular day, within the small task or objective they've got, and everybody needs to understand how they can contribute helpfully to that. I think we still have a lot of work to do to get that consensus.
So it sounds like perhaps there's not enough clarity at this point. I mean, clearly making that transition to a circular economy is a really important mission for all of us. I suppose just sticking with procurement then, and I know it's quite a specialist area, and apologies if we didn't get your document in time because of the IT problems, but I wondered what are some of the barriers and challenges around procurement? I was hearing, for example, that some local suppliers who provide goods on a leasing basis and can refurbish goods often find that they can't supply the public sector because of the way budgets are measured, and local authorities, public sector, end up buying brand new, which might sometimes be the right approach, but not always. So are these the kind of conversations that take place, and how does that then feed up to COSLA, Scottish Government, etc.?
Thank you for that question. Yeah, I see Mark has volunteered to answer this. I know procurement is an area that Mark's particularly focused on. So Mark, would you like to come in, please?
Yeah, with apologies, I put the R in before you asked about some of those barriers for local authorities. From the Scottish Water perspective, I'm not so particularly experienced in the local authority side of this, but I just wanted to kind of pick up in particular on that point around the innovation side and how we take that into the supply chain. So procurement is obviously tremendously important for us at Scottish Water towards driving net zero, because within our net zero goal, we have included the investment emissions from our capital programme. So whilst these are emissions that come from the supply chain, they're within the umbrella of what we regard as the influenced emissions that we have, and we have captured those as part of our goal. So the key thing that we've had to do there is in creation of the delivery partners and the frameworks for the current programmes is to ensure that net zero and our goals on net zero, as stated in this group with the government, are properly locked into the kind of procurement frameworks that we have. So partners that are coming on and working with us are committing to supporting these goals and are committing to having their own carbon management plans for the products and services they provide. Now, we recognise that within that there's a very, very broad range of skills and experience within the supply chain and knowledge around what that actually means for their products. Obviously, some of the big major suppliers, major construction firms, they're relatively well engaged, but then knowledge decreases, or tends to decrease as you go deeper into the supply chain. So what we've had to do is look at how we build that capacity within our supply chain to, one, understand what we're asking of them, which is to come forward to us with those low carbon or alternative materials that will deliver low carbon outcomes, but also actually how we build the low carbon designs into all of this. So as part of that, what we've had to do is create the challenge to the supply chain, but also to build the capacity to create the knowledge with them and give them the tools to help them to understand how much carbon is in the materials they procure or the services they provide, that we can then start to look at, well, what's good, what's bad, how do we drive down that carbon factor. So what we're trying to do is bring them on that journey to do that. So as I say, those tools we've made available, the embodied carbon calculators and various other things, and we've certainly shared that more broadly within the Sustainable Scotland Network Group. One of the key things we're looking to do there is to actually build that awareness across the wider public sector in Scotland, because from the Scottish Water perspective, it's not just a Scottish Water supply chain. It obviously supports broad ranges of the public sector when it comes to delivering investment. So procurement is one of the key things we have to get a grip of as a public sector, and that's one of the areas that has been a priority for us in trying to drive down the capital investment emissions. Your question on the kind of procurement rules as regards to local authorities, I'll maybe defer that to somebody else around the group, if that's okay.
Could I suggest Lorna, you want to come in on that?
Yeah, I think the points made about, for example, leasing and versus buying new, this is yeah, these conversations do take place, and we hear about them in our own local authorities at SSN and from other public bodies, I think, as well as local authorities, and a question of scale and whether or not we can come to get the range of products or services that we're looking to get and the numbers that we're looking to get. I know we have certainly looked at whether or not we can buy certain, for example, local food supplies in our own local authority, and needed to look at the question of scale and responsiveness of suppliers, etc. And sometimes that can be a barrier to some of the more new, smaller, more innovative circular economy solutions that are appearing. And I think that the challenge is on us in terms of as local authority officers, but also the network, Sustainable Scotland Network, looking at different ways that we can perhaps find to unlock some of these challenges. But no, I think these are real challenges. We need to get better at looking away from new deep solutions that are on bulk from large suppliers and beginning to be able to be more flexible in that respect. But it isn't easy. These are difficult challenges. Within the network, we certainly have been having conversations about procurement for a long time now, for many, many years. I've been a member of the network since 2006, and I think sustainable procurement has been a constant theme over that time. So these are absolutely not easy challenges, but they are things that there's a will and a desire to get beyond where we are just now. And I think we have strengthened the network in terms of bringing people together to have some of these conversations and have those conversations with other partners and stakeholders. And indeed, some of the conversations, dialogues we're having are getting beyond just the public sector. We're talking to businesses, we're talking to different sectors that we weren't before. So, for example, some of our regions moving into the realms of food and agriculture, and that started with a conversation about food procurement. So it is something that's developing. I think it's something which we need the ability to do a lot more work on to get past some of the challenges that we've got.
Thank you very much. I think in the interest of time, I have to hand back to the convener. Lorna mentioned foods, waste and procurement, which I'd love to ask questions about. So another colleague might pick that up and I might come back at the end if there's time, but back to you, convener.
Thank you very much, Monica. Let me bring in Liam Kerr to be followed by Jackie Dunbar. Liam, over to you, please.
Thank you, convener. Good morning, panel. The convener raised funding earlier on and the need to leverage private finance. Now, the Scottish Government proposes to deliver its heat and building strategy using £336 million this year and £1.8 billion by 2026. In the panel's view, is this going to be enough? And as far as you're aware, is there a sufficient plan to leverage up to the £33 billion that's apparently going to be required?
I think that's a very difficult question. I think at the moment we're quite early in the process of actually working out exactly how much it will be costing per building. So as I said, we've only just managed at Fife College to look at how we can reduce the carbon output to some of our buildings, because that seed corn funding has only recently become available, if you like. So I think it's difficult to say. I think if you say to any local authority or public body, will there be enough money to upgrade your buildings? Almost certainly the answer will be no. I think nobody will ever say you're giving us enough or too much. However, it's more a case of, well, how much do you need then? Where is the data that shows what you need to do those buildings? I know the NHS has done a lot of work on their buildings, and universities and colleges have done the same. George, I don't know if you wanted to just come in on that.
The point I was going to raise actually was in relation to procurement, but it might relate to this issue of finance. I think at the session last week, you heard a lot from the council leaders about the fact that it's how the public sector works together to identify what the effective interventions will be, and then how we use that as a portfolio for investment, whether that was public sector investment or private sector. And there was a lot of comment last week about the fact that this is not going to be purely government spend that's going to meet these targets. It's some sort of combination of public sector spend and setting the right signals, private sector meeting us on that journey, and then the role of, I suppose, individual households in terms of what steps they need to take in terms of moving this agenda. There's obviously a lot that would need to be addressed around the sort of macro economy in terms of the right pricing signals, the costing of carbon in this process, etc. So I think these issues are all kind of bearing down on us as we try and pull these plans together. I think one of the critical things that's struck me over the years is how the public sector actually gets a consistent sort of project register together, so that the public sector bodies, both individually and at a place level, understand what the interventions and the projects they want to take forward actually are. And then you can get into the detail of actually costing them and getting the right technical advice to say, is that the most cost-effective way to take this agenda forward? I think all of us on the panel would say there's an awful lot of work yet to be done in terms of actually closing the gap between the policy, essentially the climate change targets, the policies that are coming forward, and then the actual process of delivering and answering those questions in terms of who pays, how do we pay, and over what time frame. So again, SSN is playing into that space. Our final session at the conference back in December, we were looking at both finance and skills, and there's an interest in sort of kind of process, you know, even just for public sector bodies in terms of skilling up in this space. You know, it's certainly something that a lot of public sector bodies haven't had the capacity to do actively over the years in terms of actually pulling together sort of business cases at the scale that we're now looking for the next, you know, between now and the targets towards the back end of this decade. So an awful lot of work to be done there. Some of it does come down to embedding this, I think, as a corporate priority long term. I think a lot of the efforts that we've seen across the network, across the public sector over the years, it's just been a little bit too sort of sporadic, you know, good practice in pockets. And what we really now need to see is the embedding and the driving this action forward.
I'm very grateful for the answer. I think what I'm hearing, particularly from your answer, George, is that in answer to the second part of my question, that there is not yet a sufficient plan to leverage up to the $33 billion. But on that note, John Wincott, you mentioned in an earlier answer to the convener, the Scottish Green Public Sector Estate Decarbonisation Scheme. So just taking on your previous answer there, do you think that that scheme is sufficiently funded to decarbonise the public sector estate?
Thank you for getting all the right words in all the right order. I struggle with that acronym. It trips me up every time, so I won't say it again. Frankly, I did do a little jig of joy when the $95 million was first muted, especially when it was then effectively ring-fenced for organisations that had not had access to funding before. So I'm sure you're aware that organisations like colleges and the NHS can't, for instance, borrow under Salix. So we've not been able to access funding in the past that would enable us to do these building works that, for instance, other areas of the public bodies could do. So when we got that, and when there was both short-term and long-term planning money, I thought that was a really positive step. And obviously the increase from $95 million to $200 million is also extremely welcome. I think it's too early yet to say if there's enough. I mean, my hunch is probably not. I mean, I know that, you know, if you look at the NHS, their sort of initial estimates of building refurbishment requirements are, you know, quite a large spend. But at the moment, we don't know. I mean, at Fife College, where I've leveraged some of this money in, we've been given the grant. We've done our first sweep of project planning, and we've come up with budgets and costings, and we're looking at about 600,000, I think, for the first tranche of works. And then after that, there'll be more. So once you start delving into these, and this is where this pre-capital funding is really important, because it gives us a chance to bring in experts and look at what we need to do, put together project registers, as George said, and then work from that point. So I think it's early days yet. And I would hope that if solid projects come back to deliver on the goals that we're all trying to achieve, that the government will again look at the now 200 million and potentially increase it again. So my hunch is probably not, but I'd rather see the actual figures once people start doing these project registers and actually have proper quotes as to what we really, really need.
I'm very grateful. Back to you, convener.
Great, thank you very much. Liam, next up is Jackie Dunbar, to be followed by Natalie Dawn. Jackie, I will hand over to you. Thanks.
Thank you, convener, and good morning, panel. I'm interested today round about planning obligations and land value capture. So I'd be interested to hear if you think if land value capture should be directed and used proactively for achieving net zero, and what you think a robust and successful system for the land value capture would look like in practice. I'm in your hands, and who you think would be best to answer.
Thank you, and thank you for that question. I think all of us recognise that planning is one of the key levers in the hands of the Scottish Government. I would say that my panel, we're not planning experts, and there are planning experts available, but I think possibly Lorna, would you like to kick off with this, and then I'll come back at the end if necessary.
Yeah, I think when it comes to planning and that particular land capture, as John says, I'm not an expert in that area, but in terms of planning generally, I think the importance of planning framework, of MPF4, and that really being grasped and taken forward to its full potential is really, really important for this agenda. I think probably in terms of specifics around land value capture, that's probably for better place than me to provide the detail.
Thank you, Lorna. I mean, if it's okay with the committee, what I would recommend is that we take that question away and come back with a more detailed answer. But I know land value capture is a serious challenge, and I know it is one of the issues that does need to be addressed. And I would say that planning has the opportunity to bring joined up thinking, if you want to call it that, into the environment where we plan for 2050 and beyond. We don't plan for 2025. So houses shouldn't be being built today that are not fit for 2030. That all ought to be really automatically captured by planning. The land value capture is a specialist subject, and I wouldn't want to sort of pontificate on that.
Thank you, and I totally understand you not being an expert, because I am absolutely no expert myself, which is why I'm finding these questions quite interesting. Delighted if you could get back with a written question. My next question as well, I'd be happy for a written response if that's more appropriate, and it's in regards to the Section 75 agreements and the land value capture. If you think this, you know, should they be working together to deliver the infrastructure that is future-proofed and adapted to the climate emergency? Again, I'm happy for a written response if you would feel that would be better.
We will add a written response behind this, but all I would say is, having watched last week's presentation, I think Section 75 is an old tool. I mean, was it 1997, that Act? And I think it's moved, you know, the requirement has moved on tremendously. And as Aberdeen found, when it tried to broaden the scope of Section 75, it led to a court failing, which, you know, I think was a lesson for all local authorities that at the moment, Section 75s and the way they're written doesn't provide that degree of flexibility. But as I say, we will provide more detail behind that. But you're absolutely right to start questioning some of these historical planning legislations and frameworks and say, how can we now bring planning into the fold of climate change? I'm not saying that it isn't, because I think that would be unfair, but I think some of the tools in planning, well, they were written before climate change was the issue it was, and before climate emergencies were declared. So there is a need for modernisation for certain.
Yeah, thank you. And I'm still a serving councillor at Aberdeen City Council, and I was there when that happened. Back to you, convener. Sorry, not unless Lorna was wanting to come in. No. That's
okay, Jackie,
all I
thank
have,
you.
Convener. Thank you.
Yeah, thanks very much. Jackie, next up is Natalie Dawn. Natalie, over to you, please.
Thanks, convener. Good morning, panel. I'm interested in climate change reporting this morning. I'm just wondering if you can provide some extra information on how public bodies have responded to statutory emissions reporting requirements, and whether you feel there's any gaps in calculating these and reporting on emissions, and if so, how you feel these might be addressed.
Can I just thank you for the question? It's Excel spreadsheets. Climate change reporting is the tool, and it's my favourite thing in the world. So, no, absolutely, thank you. I believe that climate change reporting has tremendous possibilities when it comes to assisting public bodies in progressing. Unfortunately, I really don't think it's been used to its fullest yet. And I think this is one of the things that I've got a wish list written to bring to the committee at the very end, and that's one of the things that's on the wish list, is to better use climate change reporting. The reporting system at the moment is a little bit clunky, if we're honest. It used Proxdata as a platform, which was not originally designed for that. The actual reporting system itself is set in a statutory instrument, and so you can't change any of the questions or even any of the answer frameworks without changing the law. So that's awkward. But we are working at the moment with government officials on refreshing the whole reporting process. It is used by local authorities and public bodies. In my organisation, Fife College, we work with other colleges and compare reports. We actually swap each other's homework, mark it, and then see what each other are doing and how to improve and do things better. And local authorities do the same as well. Public bodies of similar ilks do share best practice using the reporting. But could it be done better? Absolutely. One of my suggestions would be that, for instance, this May, we will be bringing a conference together which will bring the reports back to our membership, and we'll be running a conference looking at the reports and engaging with our members on sharing best practice. I would suggest that would be something that this committee might be interested in looking at as well. So that, for instance, it could be a session looking at these reports, comparing like for like, and maybe delving a bit more detail into a bit more detail in that. I'm not aware that the committee's actually ever done that in the past, but I'm open to correction if I'm wrong. But no, thank you for the question. These reports could be a vital tool and are used by organisations, but I think they could be used more extensively.
Thanks for that answer. So kind of leading on from that, do you feel that the duty to act sustainably has made a material difference in the way public bodies plan and operate? And how do you sort of feel? Obviously, we saw additional requirements brought in last year in terms of climate change reporting. So how do you feel that these additional requirements have been received, and equally, how are they being implemented? Sorry if I cut you off there, Lorna. Apologies.
I think we have a system. Lorna will flag me if she needs to speak. Again, an excellent question. It's been in law since 2009 that public bodies must, in exercising its functions, act in the way best calculated to deliver on climate change mitigation goals, adaptation goals, and act sustainably. Now, I don't think that was necessarily rolled out into public bodies with sufficient emphasis when the law was adopted. I think it's now much more at the forefront of public bodies' minds, because, for instance, it's in the new guidance that we produced, we stated very clearly that this is a public body climate change duty, and the fact it's worded as "you must" leaves very little wiggle room. I think there's still a piece of work to be done on that. If I'm honest, I think public bodies in general do need to look at embedding these duties in everything that they do. I think there are areas of really good practice and areas that could be improved. So, yeah, a really good question, and another one of my favourite topics, so thank you for that.
Thanks. I have no further questions unless anybody else wants to come in on that. Thank you, convener.
Great, Natalie, thank you very much. Let me pass over now to Mark Ruskell. Mark, over to you, please.
Yeah, thanks very much, convener. A couple of areas that haven't been covered yet. Perhaps a few wrap-up questions. Last week's covered as well. So I can ask firstly about transport. We've not really talked about transport this morning. Obviously, post-pandemic, a lot of public sector bodies are now looking at provision of office accommodation, about transport, about, different work-life balance. I'm just wondering how that is impacting. And I suppose related to that then is the government's target for 20% reduction in vehicle mileage related to the climate target. How do you reduce that mileage down? And for travel that is essential then, how are we progressing with, procuring electric vehicles, decarbonising the essential travel that's required? So John, I don't know who you want to direct that to, but I can see Lorna nodding her head.
Yeah, Lorna, do you want to come in on that?
Yeah, happy to come in. Yeah, I think the questions around transport are so critical. It's such an important area to tackle, and it is, it's not easy. Like much of this jigsaw, it's not easy. In terms of work-life balance and actually green recovery, I think looking at transport right now, where we are still home working, there's a huge potential right now to get this right. I think it's so important that we do at this point in time. And there's been a lot of change over the past 18 months to years because of the pandemic in terms of transport. Some good things have happened, some bad things have happened, but if we don't move quickly now to make sure we're embedding the good stuff and moving away from some of the negatives, then I think we're only basically keeping building up challenges and giving ourselves more hurdles for the future. We are, I think, working well to bring EVs into our fleets and local authorities now. We've done that with funding and support, and we're now at the stage where we're moving into doing that with less necessity for that, because it's becoming a mainstream effort. I think, however, there is clearly still a long way to go. And electric vehicles on their own can't be the answer to this. When we talk about reducing that 20%, we have to understand that they're not the solution for everything. We need to look at sustainable and active travel and transport as well, especially in our towns and cities. So I think we're aware of that. It's not easy. And as a network, it's something that we do talk about and it comes up frequently. It's absolutely completely bound up as well with the questions around planning and how we deal with planning going forward with MPF4 and the way that we make these significant changes, because this isn't about a tweak here or there, it's about huge changes in the way we do things and the way we think about things. It comes right back, I think, to that question at the start about are we actually communicating about this enough, and it's not just necessarily about between Scottish Government and local authorities. I think it's about between local authorities and our communities as well, and back to that point I made, and that need for understanding, dialogue and conversation about that to have everybody on the same page moving forward. I don't know if that helps to answer your question.
That's useful. I mean, I suppose I've had a few conversations with public sector bodies in the last few months, and I know a number of them are now questioning whether they need large office spaces. So I'm just wondering, we talk a lot about the cost of carbon reduction. I'm wondering if there are kind of savings to be made, or if there's a particular trend there in terms of looking at assets that organisations have and perhaps thinking about service delivery in a different way.
Definitely. And I think that's absolutely what most local authorities are talking about right now. If using the home working models, different models of home working, agile working or hybrid, basically release the need for some of those assets and mean that we don't need them going forward, and that we can get put to other uses, or essentially we can focus on having a more appropriate estate for our needs, and more moving towards the notion of 20-minute neighbourhoods as well, so people can work closer to where they live as well, and in a lot of instances where you do need to access offices. So there's lots of potential there, but it is a significant change. At the moment, within my own local authority, we're going through a process of looking at what we can move to and what savings that will bring us. I think it's fair to say the challenge in terms of the investment we need to make in our estate to meet the 2038 target is significantly greater than any savings that we'll make through reduction of estate. That same jigsaw, and it has to all be part of a green recovery from COVID. I think there's no way that you can separate the challenges of meeting net zero, of adapting to climate change, of just transition, and of the green recovery. Those things absolutely have to be enmeshed, and in every conversation we have, that's the messages that we get back. It doesn't matter what piece of work we do, if we focus on one of those nuggets, it's the others, the other pieces that will come back in the responses and the conversations.
Mm-hmm. So not just a single budget you know, yearly conversation then, but more of a transformative change around how organisations are.
Yeah, we have tried to use our data, our information about our estate and our emissions, which essentially we started on that journey with the reporting. And I think to hark back to the earlier question on duties, it's been so important to have those duties and to have that reporting to start that data collection in our local authorities. And then we drill down into that to look at it on a service by service basis for the buildings they use and the fleet that they use and the mileage they generate. And that's actually been able to start a conversation about what it means on the ground, what it means in reality, and how each service, no matter what they are, whether they are estates or asset management, energy management, or whether they're social work or education or catering, what their own emissions are and what the implications of delivering their service means in terms of their direct scope 1 and 2 emissions, but also their wider emissions, scope 3 through procurement or transport, or all those other aspects where they have influence and the potential to show leadership.
Mm-hmm. If I might just add.
George and Mark wanted to come in, but I don't know, John.
Yeah, Mark Williams, you come in shortly, but just want to add, obviously home working is not carbon free either, and that's one of the things that was picked up in the reporting this year. When we reported, our reports included home working carbon, so public bodies needed to estimate the percentage of staff working from home, and then there was an approximate figure applied to that as a factor, but it means that we are actually reporting home working carbon. So Mark Williams, if you wanted to come in, I'm conscious of time, so obviously if you can please be brief.
I intend to come in on the report, but just maybe build on that in the context of transport. I mean, the point I make, I think, is that our public bodies reports, the repository that there is now, is such a fantastic data set of how public bodies and local authorities have regarded this over the years. What has been our transport emissions over the years? What's been our energy buildings, etc. So I think using that and getting more value from that, and looking at this in the context of our office strategies, our transport strategies, our procurement, a green fleet, the reporting side, and maybe to kind of really beef that up and get that proper comparator, really where are we as a sector? What can we learn from each other as sectors? Because it's that kind of sharing of knowledge and that repository of data that's sitting there is happy to be corrected, unparalleled for a country like Scotland. I'm not aware of that level of data existing anywhere else in the UK. And it's such a tremendous resource that we've got here to help to target and understand what the problems and the challenges are going forward. So the more we can do to leverage that value, to target those areas, and then obviously as we go through this transformative change in our hybrid models, our office strategies, our transport strategies as organisations, and obviously there's a wider thing that Lorna called on in terms of the broader transport agenda in Scotland. I think that is something that we need to keep a closer eye on and look at how we use more beneficially in the future to support that.
Mm-hmm. Thanks.
Okay, thank you very much, Mark. We have a couple of minutes of time, so let
sorry,
me
I just had one more question, and I wasn't sure if George.
Okay, go ahead, Mark. That's fine.
I'll just put my final question and then maybe George can come back on other aspects. Susan Aitken made an interesting point, the leader of Glasgow Council, last week. It was just about the capacity within council. She was talking about the capacity within her own council, the largest council in Scotland, but it's clearly an issue across multiple councils, and for smaller councils it will be an even bigger issue. And I suppose I wanted to sort of get your reflection on how councils can work together. How can there be a sharing of capacity across the public sector? SSN is obviously one route to do that, but in terms of actually creating vehicles that enable councils and public bodies to work together to create more investable propositions, whether we're talking about heat or transport procurement or any of the issues that we've spoken about today, is there enough collaboration?
Sorry, George.
John, I think you're on mute. There you go.
George, you're on mute.
Am I off mute now?
Yeah, you're off now, yeah.
Yep. I suppose, Mark, that's essentially why SSN exists and why it survived, I suppose, and why the members continue to support the network. You know, we've shifted from being a programme based on a charity and now we're sort of hybrid funded across the public sector. There's always more that needs to be done. And I think we do a huge amount of sharing. It probably rests on, you know, the core membership of the SSN is the, they are the sort of lead climate change officers in the public sector. So that's a huge asset for Scotland to drive this agenda forward with. The critical thing for us is to network beyond the network. So we're extremely well plugged in with other bits of the public sector. So you've got, I think one of the key messages coming up from this is the fact that climate change needs to be taken out of this sort of green sustainability ghetto and mainstreamed into the public sector. We're seeing that on the back of the strengthened legislation, the clarifying the sort of policy landscape, the stepping up of leadership. I think the conversation that you had last week with the leaders from the council is a reflection of that. You know, the very mature approach that Scotland's now taken around climate change and recognising the need to secure these co-benefits. You know, Lorna's mentioned the sort of green recovery, the just transition. It's the recognition that by taking action on climate change, we're actually going to build a better Scotland. And I think there's a role that the SSN's always played, which is to create that sort of, John mentioned it earlier, that trusted space, certainly for professionals to come together. And on, I suppose on top of that, we do a fair bit of work goes in that space between the likes of Scottish Government, COSLA, SOLAS, which is the Chief Executives Network, supporting leadership within the public sector. So I think it is a case of sort of building on what we've got. So I think SSN is this fantastic asset for the public sector. And it's the need, as has been mentioned, if we didn't have it, we'd have to invent it. Now we need to invest in it. It creates the platform through which participation and collaboration can be accelerated. The targets that we're facing in the next 8 years are dramatic and hugely challenging. So I think that's just a rallying call for further collaboration and more and deeper and broader collaboration using the network to support that. There's a lot of sort of policy areas that we've touched on today. We have contact with a lot of other stakeholders within the public sector and within local government that we can pull on to provide further evidence into the committee. So more than happy to do that. But in short, it's a case of sort of invest in this asset that we've got well established and well trusted within the public sector.
Okay, thanks.
Mark, thank just you, to check, do you have any questions or is that you finished? Okay, I'll take that as a yes. Well, look, just one brief wrap-up question from me, more of an observation on the evidence heard today, which reflects something that the UK Climate Change Committee has told the committee as well. It sounds like in a number of areas where fundamental change, transformational change is required, sustainable procurement, the circular economy, heat and building strategy, that in large part things are still at the conversation stage for understandable reasons. I guess the question is, when do we move to delivery? When do we move to implementation so that we can start to see some fundamental change? And in that respect, do you think the 2030 target for converting all public buildings is achievable? Or do you think that is something that is going to be very challenging? And John, perhaps that's a question for you.
Yeah, thank you, Convener. 2030 will be tremendously challenging. I think it's still possible. I think the CCC thinks it's still possible, but I think it recognises that there are huge challenges ahead. I think you're right. Procurement, as somebody said earlier, we've been grappling with procurement for a long time, and the frameworks are still not the best they could be. They're still based on pound spend, and the cheapest product isn't always the most carbon efficient product. So we need better metrics on procurement, but at least we're moving in the right direction now. Procurement is high on the agenda for SSN to start to address this year in 2022. It's going to be part of our operational plan for 2022. But as George has said, one of our key challenges is capacity. And we effectively come up with a list of areas that we would want to tackle in the coming 12 months. And then we, you know, in negotiation with Scottish Government, we cherry pick from those which are the most high priority and which can be afforded at that time. We're funded by a hybrid funding model, so some of the money comes from the Scottish Government, some from local authorities, some from NHS. So we're not a hugely wealthy organisation, and we do an awful lot of work based on the contribution in kind that our members provide rather than relying on money. All I would say is that if there are barriers to collaboration, they need to be removed wherever they're found, and it needs an agility that perhaps this committee and the government haven't had to face before, because some of these barriers have been in place for a long time. We would also say, could you, you know, we invite you to better utilise the knowledge that we bring to the situation, SSN's membership and our officers, obviously. And as the questions earlier indicated, use better the tools that already exist. So use the Climate Change Scotland Act, Section 44. Use it more formally, more forwardly, so that people are aware that this is actually a duty. And use the Climate Change Duties Report more. These are all public documents. If you go to the SSN website, you can download every public body's duty report since 2015. So anybody who's interested in how public bodies are performing on this can just go online and download a spreadsheet or a PDF document. And yet I don't see this being used anywhere near as often as it could be. So I think those would be the key asks that I would bring to this committee to look at taking forwards.
That's very helpful, John. Thank you very much indeed. And thank you to all our panel members for joining us this morning and helping the committee better understand the role of local authority delivery partners in the transition to net zero. I will now briefly suspend the meeting to allow for a change of panel. Thank you once again. Welcome back, everyone. I now welcome our second panel, comprising representatives from community groups across Scotland. These organisations are all members of the Scottish Community Alliance. I welcome Philip Revel, convener Scottish Communities Climate Action Network, and Elsa Rayburn, chairperson Community Land Scotland, both members of the Scottish Community Alliance. And I also welcome Mark McRitchie, interim chief executive, Development Trusts Association Scotland. Thank you all for joining the panel today. We have about 1 hour for this panel discussion, and we will move straight on to questions. My first question relates to a discussion we had in our previous panel. We had a discussion about the level of funding available at local authorities for the transition to net zero. It would be good to get your views on whether current funding available from local authorities match community aspirations for reducing emissions and adapting to net zero. And a related question, what are the key barriers to community organisations in accessing private finance, and what action can policymakers take to encourage more private finance to assist with community activities? Now, I will ask each panel member to respond to that question, and I will ask Philip Revel first to address the question. Over to you, Philip. Thank you.
Sorry, am I? Can you hear me?
You're on, yes.
Right, okay, thanks. Sorry, I'm not sure I quite understood the question, actually, Karina. I'm sorry. You're asking about what funding communities receive from local authorities, or are you asking funding to local authorities to support communities?
It's the first question. What funding is available from local authorities to community groups to assist community groups in your different projects that will help you deliver a local transition to net zero?
Right. Well, I think the answer to that is almost none. There's a tiny bit of funding sometimes available through local community planning partnerships that I'm aware of, but otherwise there's minimal funding I'm aware of.
I guess the question then would be, how do you raise funding if you're able to do so? What other alternative channels of funding do you have available to support community projects?
Well, they're very few and far between at the moment. It's partly directly from the Scottish Government. Up till now, for most of our members, that's been through the Climate Challenge Fund, which is now coming to an end. Otherwise, it is through other government funds which are more directed at disadvantaged communities, such as the Investing in Communities Fund, which is not currently running. Otherwise, it's other sources of finance like the National Lottery or charitable grants. But that's a real issue, is lack of any meaningful long-term funding for community-led action is a huge issue. So most of our members are dependent on volunteers for a large part of what they do.
Okay, thank you very much. And maybe I can address the same question to Ailsa Rayburn, please.
Thank you, convener. Hopefully you can hear me. Thank you for the invitation to come along and speak today. I would agree with Philip. There's very little funding directly from local authorities. Most community landowners who we represent across Scotland have been able to access central government funding. So that is the Climate Challenge Fund, as Philip says, which is coming to an end, things like CARES funding for renewables, and then through different funding sources, such as for active travel. So community and community landowners have been really quite successful at applying for and securing that type of funding for the projects they've got, but it is few and far between, and it is very resource intensive. So I think there's more opportunities for communities to work directly with local authorities, particularly in relation to funding streams that they may have or that may come online. But I think the reverse of that is also that local authorities can sort of take quite a short-termist view, and I know that's certainly not the evidence that was presented from the panel last week, but from a community perspective on the ground, there have been occasions where communities are taking this quite a broad, long-term view about projects, and they have been hindered by local authorities who are still taking a very sort of short-term, financially driven view. What is the cheapest option? That comes back to something that your previous panel were talking about, in terms of how local authorities are perhaps still slightly constrained, and I'm sure this is reflected in the funding as well, still slightly constrained by that procurement and financial management aspect that's not at the moment able to take a much broader picture of what these projects are likely to deliver and what the value is in getting communities involved in delivery. So I think that's the answer to the first part of your question. I don't know if you want me to answer the second part of the question yet, or if you want to go on to Mark.
Yeah, please, Ailsa, if you could address the second question and then I'll move on to Mark. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, convener. There's a number of barriers to communities accessing private finance, community landowners. There have been obviously some really successful cases, but again, they're few and far between, but they're great examples we can learn from, such as down at Langham in the Borders, which were able to work with private funders via intermediary organisations like John Muir Trust and the Woodland Trust around issues like carbon offsetting and philanthropic donations. So I think in terms of accessing private finance, community landowners have, are starting down that route. There are things that government could do to support them in that, and that is around the models of community governance. and are currently under the Community Right to Buy and Scottish Land Fund, if they could be broadened out to enable more private interests on board, still with the communities being in control and leading on the development. But I think there are opportunities, and I know it's something the Scottish Land Commission are looking at the moment, to think about different models of involving more private finance, particularly around things like carbon offsetting income in the future. As well as being the chair of Community Land Scotland, I'm also chair of the Isle of Egg Heritage Trust, and we've been able to work with some intermediary organisations to start to draw down this type of finance, but still keeping the overall principles of you know, developing the circular economy, building local community wealth, local democratic governance, etc. So I think there are opportunities to move more in the direction of bringing in private finance, but still obviously keeping those underpinning principles, which are really important.
That's great, Ailsa. Thank you very much. And same question to Mark McRitchie, please.
Good morning, committee, and thank you, convener, for the opportunity to come and participate and share reflections of DTAS and our 300 community-based members that range in a whole variety of scale, from very much the volunteer-based setup that Philip referred to, right the way through to trading organisations that are asset owning. I think the experience that my colleagues have mentioned is true, that there have been some exceptional organisations that have worked as exemplars, really, in terms of being able to progress this with a patchwork of funding that's come from a multitude of sources. They primarily haven't been local authority led, and there certainly is a concern as CCF comes to an end in March as to whether or not actually there's a bit of a cliff edge in terms of existing activity that's going on within communities. The pressure on local government budgets that Councillor Lang mentioned last week, we kind of recognise and we see there is issue definitely about capacity and resources around that, and whether that's about internal expertise, as Councillor Aiken kind of mentioned. So we recognise that bit. So it isn't just about the kind of funding programme, it's about the support that goes alongside that in terms of what's going on. Having said that, there are great examples out there of work that has gone on around kind of the whole element about net zero in its broader sense. And I think what we've seen as part of a legacy from COVID is some examples, for instance, around community food provision with the pantries and community fridges, which is actually having an impact on waste, which really have come through the community response, which was quite amazing across the country due to COVID. With regard to the kind of private finance, I think, you know, Ailsa's points, if I can just build on those rather than repeating them, I think there is a bit about, there is an element about being risk averse within community organisations. Quite often there is not an asset base, and whilst they're entrepreneurial, quite often the approach has been to build things with very little kind of starter elements. And the concern, I suppose, really is this element about the finance has to be paid back, what happens if things don't go according to plan, and how, you know, what is then left, the damage that then does. And unfortunately, we have experience of members that has happened, and there's been damage to that kind of infrastructure, and really the community has taken time to kind of recover. So it's I suppose, one that organisations are quite concerned about. There's been certainly a lot of conversation about, you know, is this the only route, or can we actually be more creative in our approaches around financing community-based activity?
Thanks very much, Mark, and thank you everyone for those responses. You've touched on a number of issues that I know my colleagues want to explore. So let me hand over to Fiona Hislop. Fiona, over to you.
Thank you for joining us today. I'm interested in some of the positives, as in what community organisations want to do in the net zero space, but in their relationship with local councils in doing that, if there isn't funding streams from locals as yet, what support can local authorities give? And particularly in heat and buildings, I'm interested in that, that the power of local organisations to help influence and deliver on this, it might have a great possibility. But of course, as already mentioned, you've got volunteers are the backbone of these community organisations. And if it's central funding that's been given, and most of that is capital or for projects, is there an issue around people capacity and what's needed in terms of the people resource to help communities do the projects if councils are only interested in what they finance or in short term, in very brutal terms, but obviously we've heard that. So I'd like to hear from all three of you if that's possible. And then, Convener, I'm quite happy after that to hand back to you. So can I maybe come to Philip first and then to Mark and then to Ailsa. So Philip.
Thank you, Fiamma. Yeah. I think the point I'd make is at the moment that there's really a fundamental mismatch in scale between so-called local government and the scale that local community groups operate at, and that's a fundamental problem. And there's also a fundamental issue of sort of culture and mindset, I think, because I think government in Scotland generally has a very top-down, centralising mindset, and local authorities frequently at the moment don't really see communities as key strategic partners. But in terms of, I mean, communities are very keen very often to work with their local authority, but there is that problem of mismatch of scale, and just finding a way in can be very difficult for a small local community group to find the way in to the right person to speak to in the council and the right way of getting support. And what doesn't help is the fact that, I mean, you mentioned about people resource, and that's really what's been lacking over the last 10, 20 years, I think, is the way that community learning and development services have been completely slashed. So in many parts of Scotland, there's really very little community development work done by councils now, and really that is a vital function that communities need. So I don't know if that answers your question, so I'm not sure I've remembered your point.
Philip, that's very helpful. And then could I come to Mark, please?
Thank you. Yes, I think we all agree that the vision is right, and for many community organisations, we're very much at the early stage. And I think, though there is an element about people capacity, our internal work looking at core investment has certainly seen the benefit of giving relatively small sums to organisations does enable there to be a start of synergy around activity. And I think the net zero really agenda kind of does very much fit into that. I think there is a bit of really caution really at the moment, where a lot of my members are still in the recovery phase, where despite being a huge amount of work in the COVID environments, have actually, if we're specific with our training, have not returned to pre-COVID levels, and they're now very much focusing on, you know, this year of the squeeze. So there is definitely pressure there, and net zero then becomes another thing to do. And how does that fit with the kind of current resources that they have? I would also come back with the point about local authorities not having resources. They perhaps don't fund community-based activity, but clearly what was being talked about by all the local authorities was some eye-watering numbers in terms of investment needed and where that investment might come from. And I think there's really some concerns about their approach, because I'm quite disappointed that council leaders continue to use 20th century approaches to a 21st century problem. We continue to look at kind of private finance of scale, and then there's a bit about business cases and sometimes where the key benefit of net zero might not stack up in a financial sense. So where do those projects go? There is a bit where inward investment was used, I think, by a number of particularly cities as being the kind of model, but we know that trickle down doesn't happen. So if there is going to be this investment coming in, where is the green jobs in that, and how do we ensure that these green jobs are in our communities, and we don't end up kind of exporting actually that work? And I think it's interesting, some of the moves that were announced the other day with the County Estate Scotland, where there's actually talk about, you know, building capacity in the Highlands to fabricate the turbines that will come, as opposed to, you know, bringing them in from Germany or wherever. And I think the other bit is procurement. There's been discussion today on that, as well as last week. And again, there is an unwritten kind of approach around scale, that we have to do this at scale, but actually some of the great creativity and therefore maximum net zero benefit actually comes from looking at how we do procurement. At the moment, it prevents participation, it locks us out. Research done by Locality, my English colleagues, actually showed there was great benefits of doing contracts at a lower scale, and we have ability to be creative in that and do some, you know, advanced learning. And yet local government continues to think about scale rather than a diversity which can add to the richness of what we're trying to do.
Thanks, Mark. And I think if you can send in the committee any good examples that you've seen across Scotland of good projects, that would be helpful. Can I come to Ailsa and then I'll return back to the convener? Ailsa, please.
Thank you, Mrs. Love. Yeah, examples are really important, I think, because a lot of communities, particularly community landowners, and you know, I really take Mark's point that without assets, community organisations can be risk averse, but with assets, be they land or buildings, then communities are able to take more risks. And some communities have been involved in that really successfully. So we produced a report last year, which I'd like to send on to the committee, called Community Landowners and the Climate Emergency. And that gave really six really great case studies of where communities are already at delivery stage. So we were talking before about how do we move from thinking to delivery. And, you know, if you look in Carloway Estate Trust, you know, they were picked by Nature Scot as an exemplar of peatland restoration, and they're taking forward those projects now. If you look at Brookhaven and Methil, there's a community organisation there that's running several food projects and community growing projects, local food production. If you go over to the west coast to Gia, you know, they were at the forefront of community energy in 2005, so almost 20 years ago. And the income they've got from their four turbines, they've used to bring their housing stock up to a really good standard and start on works around energy efficiency. They've done an active travel project, reduced car use, and then other places, the Lister Housing Cooperative in Edinburgh, they were the first organisation to get the consent for solar thermal panels on a B-listed building. So there's lots of examples of communities that have got assets, and obviously from a Community Land Scotland perspective, that's absolutely critical that they have ownership of the assets, that they can start looking at different routes and they can start thinking slightly differently. So I'd like to share that report with you if I can, please, because I think there'd be some useful things in there. I think the other issue around community-led activity and why it would be really useful to get more local authority support is that the Scottish Government's own report, own research shows that 60% of emissions reductions is going to have to be social. It's going to have to be from people rather than technological. And again, you can demonstrate, there's evidence to show that community-led projects influence behaviour change. So I mentioned that I'm the chair of the Isle of Egg, and Egg has its own first, certainly in Scotland, 24-hour, 365 days a year, completely dependent on renewable energy. And that's part of the solution. But the other part of the solution is actually to get people to use less energy. So there's lots of projects in place on Egg, which are certainly scalable and transferable to other similar locations where you can educate people how to use less resources and less energy. So I think there's lots of really useful lessons that can be learned. But coming back to local authority support, there are issues around the short-termism we've spoken about and the financial constraints they're working under. Revenue support to develop community capacity is absolutely critical. And Highlands and Islands Enterprise have obviously been doing that for a number of years, which has been very successful. So I think those sorts of schemes need to be rolled out, particularly in the south of Scotland, and further cemented in HIE area to support communities. And that staff capacity, as I think you said, you know, these organisations are, the boards are all volunteers, I'm a volunteer. And, you know, we don't have the skills and resources, but with relatively, you know, actually very, very little investment in staff capacity, you can do really fantastic things. So I think those would be the key messages about how, if you're going to get more local authority involvement, actually supporting that skills development through staff capacity at a local level would be really, really important. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Shields are very helpful. Can I pass back to the convener now, please? Thank you.
Thank you very much, Fiona. Let me bring in Monica Lennon for the next question. Monica, over to you, please.
Sorry, I'm getting a message on the screen. I had to reconnect. I've missed the last 5 minutes, so apologies for that, having some IT problems. I wanted to pick up on the theme of waste management and the role of public bodies in Scotland on the journey to circular economy. So today I want to pick up with panel two about the role of communities in that. So I suppose I'm wondering then how well are local authorities involving communities in that full agenda? I heard some frustrations earlier on about resources and about some of that engagement. So really interested to hear what the main challenges and opportunities are. And start with Philip, if that's okay.
Asking specifically about waste management and circular economy, yeah?
Yes, that's correct.
Yeah, I mean, there's lots of examples of where communities and local authorities are working together to intercept waste before it goes to landfill, for example, and then put it into sort of reuse hubs and that sort of thing. But generally, it comes back to my first point, that at the moment it is extremely challenging for small local community organisations to collaborate meaningfully with local authorities because of the mismatch of scale. And the fact that too often local authorities don't see community groups as key strategic partners. So that is a real challenge. And my hope is that through the new sort of regional networks that are emerging and which will then hopefully transition into regional community climate action hubs, then it will be much easier to establish a more strategic approach, a more collaborative work between the public sector and community organisations. But there's a desperate need for infrastructure in communities to enable them to really create local circular economies. And that's not just around managing waste, but reducing waste in the first place and creating a more sharing economy and setting up things like tool libraries and sharing libraries in general, and reuse hubs and repurposing workshops and so on. So sorry, I'm not sure if that's really addressed your question.
That's very helpful. That's very helpful, Philip, to get us started. Perhaps come to Ailsa next to maybe add to that or add in some different thoughts.
Thank you. I would agree with Philip that there are lots of projects that communities have been leading on in terms of local reuse hubs, recycling, that have been very successful. And it again comes back to this whole issue that it's a local project, so you're able to influence local behaviour. So I think one of your previous panellists talked about all of these things cannot be top down. They don't work when they're top down. And a lot of local authorities are actually, too big. They're not able to work on the scale of a local community. So if I think of Highland Council based in Inverness, you know, and then the situation on Egg is able to organise its own facilities, but they're very remote, and Highland Council itself, and that's absolutely no criticism of the officers who are extremely helpful and councillors, but the system doesn't really work because the scale is so different. So I think that's an issue. If you could look at working on a much more local scale, that that would be really helpful. I think the circular economy point is a really interesting one, because I know several community landowners now who are developing really quite significant projects, often with Scottish Government support through its various funding streams, and one of their key outcomes is developing that circular economy. So it's how they can use local materials, how they can use local labour, how they can ensure the benefits from these projects stay as far as possible within local communities and are not leached out. So I think that's something that it would be really interesting to talk about in more detail from a, both a procurement perspective and a grant funding perspective. You know, how that could be one of the outcomes of grant applications is how you are going to help build that local community wealth and that circular economy to get every type of organisation, including communities who are pretty good at it, thinking about how they use those national resources to build sort of local assets.
Thank you. Again, that's helpful. The same question to Mark.
Thank you. I think the overall impression is still that local government is doing waste management onto its residents, and therefore they are passive in this kind of process. And it's interesting, there was an example talked about last week about reducing the number of uplifts of the black bins, and that, you know, presented as that, well, that's a way of actually saving kind of net zero in carbon, when actually to the communities it's seen as a reduction in service. And yet the individual residents are interested in kind of what's going on. So there's a bit about, you know, bring us into the conversation, treat us as adults. There's an element about kind of understanding kind of that, and let's have that kind of conversation. To the broader point about the circular economy, again, one of the local authorities mentioned last week about the IT distribution and the reuse of computers. In Glasgow, that was very much led by the third community and voluntary sector, in terms of its delivery, because they were able to reach out and ensure that that was given to those who are digitally divided, because there's an element about that which again has been highlighted in the last 2 years. So there is some examples, there are some work there. It's just how that gets done at scale. There is definitely social enterprise activity around circular economy, and again there are development trusts that have kind of done some work with either independent social enterprises to look at repair hubs. We were actually, rather than throwing away the old toaster, we're trying to see how we can fix it and give it, you know, extend its economic life. I think there are elements which could be extended and evolved across the network.
Thank you, Mark. I might stick with you and then come back to Ailsa and then finish with Philip for my next question. I thought that was a really interesting comment you made, Mark, about communities often feeling that things are being done to them and are not fully engaged in the conversation. If I give the example of food waste, maybe if each of you can give your perspective on how, whether it's development trusts, community groups, community landowners, can be involved in really sort of driving change and action and raising awareness. I've been speaking to Zero Waste Scotland recently about food waste in particular. It's a hugely challenging issue for the local authorities and right across the public in the third sector. So if I can stick with you, Mark, do you have any ideas or feedback on that?
Yeah, certainly. I think some of the early phases of climate challenge funding did actually very much support kind of food as opposed to use of food and food waste as opposed to kind of growing. So there are some good examples there. Unfortunately, we were subjected to effectively a postcode lottery. So there was an element about projects were successful for a couple of years, that then was a move across. So those who were postcodes who were not successful then got funded, which then left the ones that had done some really innovative work kind of stuck. I think the models evolved, and I think it's interesting to see how pantries have come on board. And again, a good number of members have done that, which is very much seen as a much more dignified kind of way to look at food provision. Many are driven by surplus food and food close to end of its dates. I think the community food Bridge network, which is a UK-wide network, but there's an aspiration to grow them in Scotland too, is a slightly different kind of model, where there is potential for donations across members as well as surplus food, but it's very much at the early stages. But we do have, you know, members with bases, assets, as Ailsa indicated, across the country that could be good places to go, which are seen as trusted places. And that's certainly something that could be really interesting as it kind of evolves. And food is very much a social thing, and is therefore very powerful when we're looking at community.
That's very helpful, Mark. If I can turn back to Ailsa, and I wonder, it's a supplementary, but Ailsa, you talked about for those councils that are larger and it can be more difficult to get engagement right. You know, what advice do you have, or what would you like to see them try differently? Because we're not going to change the size of our local authorities overnight, but I doubt it.
Okay, no, thank you. Well, the first point then around food waste, I think that comes back to my earlier point about driving behaviour change, and that is very effectively done at a local level. So some of the community landowners, particularly in the Outer Hebrides, Golson and Carloway, they worked with the communities around really straightforward things, like light bulbs and getting the house.
Monica, it looks like we may have lost Ailsa. Do you want to move on to your next question?
Yes, if we can move on to Philip then, and perhaps come back to Ailsa if she reconnects.
Thank you. Yeah. I mean, as Ailsa said, I mean, there's lots of examples across Scotland of community run larders and pantries and fridges and so on, which are making use of making food available, which would otherwise have gone to waste, and sort of community run supper clubs and so on, again, using food which supermarkets would have thrown out. But there are also lots of projects to try and close the loop more locally, more local composting schemes, for example, which keep nutrients locally. But there's a much bigger issue there, I think, around how we address food poverty and how we create a less wasteful food system. So for me, this is really about the much bigger issue around how we really rethink the economy and how we create local well-being economies. And just coming back to your point about not changing the scale of local authorities, I mean, I'm not actually suggesting that. I think we need the local authorities at the scale they are, but we also need a much more local scale of democracy that communities can actually relate to.
That's helpful. Thank you, Philip. And you'll probably be aware there's a right to food bill that's been proposed by an MSP. So, again, that's something you might want to engage with. Convener, it looks like we don't have Ailsa. I'm happy to hand back to you. And if Ailsa returns, perhaps we can hear from her towards the end.
That's great, Monica. I think we may have Ailsa. I'm not 100% sure, but let me just check to see if Ailsa is available. No, Monica, I think you are right. We can come back to Ailsa, hopefully, in a short moment. Let me hand over to Natalie Dawn. Natalie, over to you.
I've touched on some of the challenges that communities face, talking about finance, volunteers, and sort of relationships with local authorities. I'm not sure if you feel there are any further challenges, or if we can maybe focus on a little bit more of the positive side, if there's any opportunities for community-led emissions reductions and a just transition associated with that, and in which sectors you feel that there are opportunities for innovation, learning, and partnership. I'll come to Mark first, and then Philip, and then Ailsa, if she's available at the end.
Very, very good question. Absolutely opportunities to work. And I think certainly the development trusts that I kind of work with are very much can-do organisations and are keen to work. And I think, you know, Philip's point about scale and engagement is certainly a kind of challenge in that. But there's still nevertheless kind of interesting things that are going to come through from that. And I think it was Council Leader Davidson that kind of talked about the charging infrastructure and about putting charging points up the Coast 500s. And, you know, things like that are interesting, and there's an opportunity there for community organisations to kind of be involved in that and to be kind of charging points. And, you know, I suppose really with the assets that we have spread across the country, there could well be charging points around in community, next to community buildings, because one of the issues with charging infrastructure is not the infrastructure itself, but the fact that many of them are not actually working properly. So, you know, folks with the EV have EV cars have certainly talked about having to go to multiple charging points. So if we have a charging point that's the responsibility of a development trust, for instance, we might find that that's looked after because actually it is connected to the sustainability, and there's a vested interest in having that charging point or points kind of working. So I think there's things like that that would be really kind of quite interesting to see and how that would work. I think the element about kind of active travel, my colleague was involved in a discussion with the Scottish Government just the other week, and there was a lot of talk about active travel in terms of the quality of pavements and ensuring that pavements are up to scratch. And I totally agree to that living in Glasgow. But one of the rural participants kind of, you know, flagged up, you know, what's a pavement? I don't have any pavements. So we have to remember that active travel does mean different things in different places. And we do have communities where the infrastructure, whether that's in public transport, or pavements aren't kind of the same, and therefore we need to kind of think about how that kind of works. And we certainly have members, for instance, that are involved in looking at community transport and how we kind of effectively kind of deal with a public transport setup that's very patchy. I mean, there's certain parts of Glasgow you cannot get to after 6 o'clock at night. So there's a bit about how does that work in terms of engaging people with work opportunities and being part of the metropolitan life, and that, you know, that's in our largest city, so it's going to be worse in different kind of communities. So there is opportunity there, and I know that there's been some interesting work done around with our colleagues in Community Transport Association around community transport. The element there, again, comes to the technology. You know, the policy in some ways is ahead of the technology. We still don't have high-capacity minibuses that are electric. You know, so the difference there from a 9-seater to a 16-seater doesn't maybe sound very much, but in terms of a viability question at a community transport level, you know, does cause some challenges. So there are initiatives there that we've seen and have the potential to do that connect to other aspects of the broader kind of agenda.
Thanks, Mark. Sorry, I'll come to Philip next. Thanks, Mark.
Thanks, Natalie. Am I on?
Yeah, you're on.
So, in terms of, can you hear me, yeah?
Yep.
In terms of opportunities, there's huge opportunities. SCAM, the Scottish Community Scotland Action Network, has a vision really over just an equitable Scotland in which communities are really empowered to use their collective intelligence and local knowledge to really create locally adapted solutions for a zero carbon future. And there's a huge amount of creativity and willingness in communities to try and make that happen, but they just need the basic infrastructure and resources in order to really unleash community-led action. And that's not action just on the climate emergency, but really the opportunity is really to join up a whole raft of agendas and really rethink what sort of future we're trying to create and how can we ensure well-being for all in a thriving environment. So it's key really we take climate action out of its environmental silo and see how that tackling the climate emergency can also tackle inequality and disadvantage and biodiversity loss and so on. And I don't know if you've seen it, I did send in a short paper prior to this, giving outlining the infrastructure and resources which communities need in really to unleash community-led action. Because we don't need to keep reinventing the wheel. We know what works, and in outline terms, what every community actually needs to really, as I say, unleash community action. Because the challenge we face is unprecedented. None of us have been here before. So we really need to find ways to tap into everybody's collective intelligence at all levels. And local knowledge as to how we can create those local solutions. But it's potentially a hugely exciting opportunity. So we need to be very careful not to overwhelm people with and cause them to lose hope and fall into despair, because time is very short, but actually it is potentially a very exciting opportunity to transform our way of life and the economy.
Absolutely, I absolutely agree. Thank you. Thanks, Philip. I'm not sure if Ilza, if you heard my question or if you've got anything else to add, you're welcome to.
Am I unmuted now? Yeah, great. Sorry, I didn't hear your question. Are you happy just to repeat it really quickly?
Yeah, it was essentially just we've spoken around some of the kind of biggest challenges facing communities, such as finance and volunteers and sort of relationships with local authorities. So it was just trying to focus on more of the positive side of that, looking at the opportunities for community-led emissions reductions, and in which sectors there might be opportunities for innovation, learning and partnership. Stemming from that. Thanks.
Okay, thank you. Yeah, I think communities have got, you know, decades of experience of working in partnership, because for so long they weren't able to deliver things themselves. They had to do things with partners. So it's only since communities have started to acquire more assets and influence that they have been able to move ahead and take some of these risks that perhaps other public sector partners haven't been able to do. So I'd certainly reflect Philip's point about there's absolutely no lack of ambition within communities to make their places better places. You know, they're very focused on what can we do to make this a better place to live, to bring up our children, to ensure that young people have got, you know, decent housing and can stay here. So I think there's lots of really great lessons that individual communities can share. Certainly some of the challenges that have already been outlined in terms of, you know, they're often volunteer boards, you do get volunteer burnout, there is need for more skills training, there is need for more staff capacity, but we've seen where those models work, so we're not reinventing the wheel there, it's just learning from things that do work, as I've said with HIE and the support that they put into community development over a number of years, could certainly be rolled out more widely. I think the other point I make is that, you know, for many communities, the climate emergency is not in a silo. You know, it's just part of everyday things that a community needs to think about to make it more sustainable in human terms and financial terms and environmental terms. So they do see the picture in the round. You don't tend to have the silos that perhaps we've talked about a wee bit with public agencies and the need to break out of those silos. Certainly from a community landowner's perspective, they will look at the sustainability of their community in the broadest sense, and whether that is people, whether it is money, whether it is jobs, whether it's housing, or whether it's the environment. I think there's lots of lessons that we can learn and scale up if we have the right sort of resources invested in communities and developing some of those partnerships. We've taught partnerships with the public sector and with intermediary organisations, like say the Communities Housing Trust, have been really successful, but also with the private sector. I was involved with the acquisition of the island of Ulva, and Macquarie Bank there, the Australian bank, were really keen to engage, and they saw a lot of benefit in engaging in those types of projects. And we're seeing more private companies wanting to invest in community-led projects because they see that broader sustainability picture. So I think we can do a lot more around scaling up that type of activity if we've got the right resources and skills in place. I think it's really positive. I think coming back to Philip's point, there's lots of things that we can do, and there's certainly no lack of ambition.
All right. Thank you all. That's great. Back to you, Convener.
Thank you very much, Natalie. Next up, we have Jackie Dunbar. Jackie, over to you, please.
Thank you, convener, and thank you, panel, for coming today. Couldn't agree more with you when you're speaking about communities being the best place to tell us what they need in regards to the problems that we're facing moving forward. And of course, different communities will have different problems and different solutions. And my question is around about transport in regards to active travel and public transport. I think they are key moving forward to try and reduce private car use. But again, some communities I feel will be able to reduce their private car use a lot more than what others would be able to. So can I ask the panel, how do they think communities can work with public bodies and local businesses to encourage the use of more sustainable forms of travel, whatever that may be for their communities? If I could start with Philip, please, if you don't mind.
Thank you, Jackie. There's all sorts of ways. Communities need the infrastructure, basically, and that doesn't just mean it does mean sort of active travel infrastructure such as paths and safe ways to cycle and so on, but also car sharing schemes, car sharing clubs, and peer to peer car sharing and that sort of thing. Decent interconnected public transport, but fundamentally also reducing the need to travel is absolutely fundamental. And at the moment, I think that's not talked about enough. I mean, getting to net zero isn't just going to be a question of changing to electric cars. We fundamentally need to rethink how we get around and why we need to get around. And there's lots of opportunities for localizing economies so that people are able to work and play locally, rather than having to travel as much as they do at the moment. Including the way we manufacture stuff. I mean, there's no need at the moment anymore to have supply chains which extend around the whole world. We can set up much more local manufacture, so-called sort of Cosmo local, where you've got global design but local manufacture of items, which will also enable much more of a local circular economy as well. And items are reached the end of their life, they can go back to the manufacturer to be repurposed and remanufactured, for example. So it's connects with everything, basically, is what I'm saying.
I couldn't agree more. Can I go to Ailsa and then to Mark, please, if you don't mind? Sorry, I should have maybe have said that.
Yeah, thank you for the question. Your opening statement there about communities being best placed to tell us what they need and what works locally is absolutely right, because what would work on Mull wouldn't work in Glasgow. I think this whole issue about public transport is we really need to think about that in terms of local, particularly remote and rural communities, and what's the best solution for them. And it isn't going to be the same across the country. I've already mentioned that communities are at the forefront of a lot of this type of work. So certainly Huntly up in Aberdeenshire, which some of you would know, they've got a big active travel project. They're developing safe routes to school. They've got a car club over on Gear. The big issue there is trying to reduce the number of car-borne visitors to the island, because there's only one road on the island. So they have worked with local partners to develop the cycling. They've worked with CalMac to reduce the number of cars that are coming across on the ferry. They've developed a campsite so people don't need to bring their car. So communities have got solutions to the local problems and how to reduce car-borne travel. And as I say again, there's lots of good examples that could be scaled up elsewhere. I think that the big thing that I would say is that a lot of the funding schemes that fund these types of projects, and be interested on Mark's view if he's coming after me, tend to be too short. It's like it's here and then it's gone again within 6 months. So communities don't get the time to plan. So I think that the funding schemes that have been really successful, things like, say, the Scottish Land Fund, which I'm particularly aware of, it's going to be there for 5 years. So a community can plan, it can consult, it can develop the partnerships, it can get match funding, it can talk to the businesses, and then it can make an application application and deliver a project. It's really sort of short-termism, and that, you know, you've got a particular funding pot because it's in relation to something that Scottish Government in particular are really keen on at the moment, and it's gone in 6 months, and, you know, you're not getting the benefit from all the capacity building work that communities are doing around these projects. So I think that would be one of the things. There's lots of examples that could be scaled up and lots of the learning that we can use from existing communities. But a plea, if we're going to have funding, whether that's from local authorities or central government, that they're actually long term, at least 3 years, so communities can plan. Because for all the reasons we've talked about, the volunteer boards, they're really understaffed. You know, it's not a local authority that can say, right, OK, we'll devote one whole person staff time to doing this particular project. Community organisations don't have that luxury. Thank you. I'll perhaps pass over to Mark.
Thank you.
Thank you. Yes, I think I would just really echo Ailsa's comments around the time frame for development, and these things, to improperly embed them, as one of our colleagues mentioned earlier this morning, it does take time to do that and get engagement and understanding about the process. In terms of practical things, there's definitely current car club models, and I have members who are involved in that and are supporting that quite actively. We've also heard the development of things like cycle libraries, and so there's an element about, again, should have their own bike as opposed to their own car. So is there about around that in terms of options that might be available? I think the issue about localising economies is really significant that Phil makes around. We have seen really a dilution of public services in communities, and, you know, for example, health has become very much centralised. There is that element about folks having to travel further to access health. There is that element about how healthy is our high street. And I have member trusts who are very actively involved with our colleagues with Scottish Towns Partnership, trying to look at what services are there, how do we encourage healthy, diverse towns across the country that means that folks, you know, genuinely have a 20-minute neighbourhood. And the more general point, I think, again, one of our colleagues earlier this morning made the point that we're in an interesting environment now in terms of that recovery. We've had 2 years where we've had the 20 minutes of local exercise. And for many of us, that was probably the first time we actually got out of our cars on a regular basis and kind of, you know, were out kind of walking. And I think there's a bit where with families, how do we encourage them to not just, you know, dive back into the car, whether it's diesel or electric powered, but actually think about kind of what's around them. That will, I think, raise some interesting questions, because we have communities where the concept of a 20-minute neighbourhood just is a joke, really, because it just doesn't apply. It's just not feasible. There is an element about the kind of pressures that just will bring by taking away their ability to, you know, be able to access those parts of life that we need to do. So it's kind of an interesting question. I think on the broader thing, I think it was George this morning mentioned about the public register projects. And I think that would be really interesting, because that would potentially give us an opportunity early doors to see what is being suggested and planned, and therefore communities could help contribute to that, rather than local authorities kind of almost present it as this is what we're going to do, it's all done and dusted. There's an opportunity to see, guys, if you did this, possibly there could be added value to both the capital and the revenue, which might think things quite creative. And we saw when in community empowerment there was a register of surplus assets, communities went, we could do X, Y, and Z with it in a way that local authorities and public bodies hadn't even thought of. And I think the same could apply to net zero projects.
Thank you very much. That's all I have, convener, so back to you.
Great, Jackie. Thank you very much. Let me bring in Mark Ruskell. And if I could just mention to panel members, we're running slightly up against the clock, so if answers could be quite succinct, that would be very helpful. Mark, over to you, please.
Yeah, thanks, convener. I mean, clearly, there's been a bit of a theme this morning around access to resources. I wanted just to come back to Ailsa around, and Mark perhaps as well, just around access to land, because it seems that, you know, as we're tackling climate emergency, developing renewables, you know, putting in place nature recovery, carbon sequestration, all of that, that communities could have a role there, but access to land is perhaps a concern. And, you know, there's been issues raised about green lands and, you know, private sector investment in land as well. So I just wanted to ask you kind of what you saw as the most important next steps in terms of land reform, if communities are going to become more involved in both climate adaptation and mitigation. Go start with Ilse.
Thank you for that question. I mean, I think we all know that land and land use are really going to be key to Scotland's ability to meet its net zero requirements. So it's obvious there's going to be significantly more tree planting and long-term forest management, peatland restoration, soil improvement, retention, salt moss restoration as a carbon store, et cetera, et cetera. So all of these activities are land-based. So there are really major policy changes that we need to make to connect these land use imperatives to ensure both a just transition and to build community wealth. So from Community Land Scotland's perspective, the land market is still dysfunctional and failing. It's certainly failing in those ambitions for a just transition. And as it stands at the moment, it's at least going to undermine or likely defeat the ability of local authorities and their partners to rise to those challenges of achieving net zero. So I think more regulation around the land market. We've got the opportunity of the Land Reform Bill that's coming to start to address some of these highly speculative investments that we're seeing at the moment, particularly in rural land, which is driving up land prices hugely and not only stopping communities, but stopping other organisations like Forest Land Scotland or the Crown Estate Scotland or local authorities to be able to engage in that market to acquire land to help deliver Scotland's long-term land-based net zero strategies. So I think there's a real danger of all the available land that is suitable for this type of use being sucked up by this superheated private investment market, because Scotland's land market is unregulated and anybody can engage in it. And we're seeing these values really being driven by the anticipated future rising in capital values, which we're seeing at the moment, and underpinned by public subsidy. So it's that public subsidy and the land value rises, which is helping entrench wealth in pockets that are already wealthy and really stopping other organisations, and I say particularly from our perspective communities. But we are also seeing organisations, as say like Forest Land Scotland, Crown Estate Scotland, who could interact in this market and buy up some of this carbon potential for Scotland, because that's what we're talking about. It's like, how are we going to save some of that carbon potential for what Scotland is going to need in the future, because we are never going to, we're assuming, be able to deal with all of our emissions. So we're going to need some carbon offsetting. And at the moment, that's all being sucked up by the private sector, which is not delivering a just transition and not delivering community wealth. So I think, yeah, there are issues around things like public interest test, more land market regulation, possibly a new right to restore type of right to buy for communities, things communities being able to list things like sites of you know, particular interest for communities to lead on local restoration, which they have proved beyond doubt they can do. And again, you know, I'll send you the study that shows that. And I think there's also really interesting opportunities for local authorities and organisations like Crown Estate and Forest Land Scotland to partner with communities. So more of this bringing organisations together. So I know that's obviously my pet topic, so I'll pass over to Mark now. But I think there's a huge amount that can be done to start to address some of these issues to ensure that Scotland has the capacity within its loan land to deliver net zero.
Yeah, thanks for that. That's comprehensive. Mark, do you have anything to add to that?
Yes, I think Niels is very comprehensive. I would just make some couple of points, really, I suppose, just about the concern about this buying up of land for carbon credits and locking out communities, and the concern about that, particularly from an international perspective with the offset. I think there is an opportunity around vacant and derelict land. There is a huge kind of scale of how we utilise that. And there's been some very early kind of work done by some of our members looking at that. So again, there's an element about it's how do we kind of maximise that to the benefit. And there's been some creative kind of work done that within that. And I think it should sit within that broader kind of context of kind of net zero as well.
Okay, thanks. That's useful. And then in terms of resources as well, I mean, Philip, you mentioned earlier on about CCF fund, coming to a close at the end of this March. I mean, the government has now shifted into a new program of climate action hubs. There's been some limited investment in climate action towns as well. I wanted just to get your reflection on whether climate action hubs, that model, is effectively kind of taking CCF onto a more mainstream rollout of solutions, or whether there's been any issues with that. What the reaction has been within your members, within your network.
Land is a fundamental resource and asset, and at the moment too often communities just don't have access to that fundamental resource on their doorstep, and that really does limit what they're able to do. And land prices is obviously another huge issue which really urgently needs to be addressed. And that ties in with the planning system, which again at the moment too often is totally disempowering communities. But to answer your question about climate hubs, that's at very early stages yet. I mean, SCAN is actively supporting the Scottish Government in rolling out community climate action hubs, and we think they can play a key role in enabling a more strategic and collaborative approach, and to help link community-led action up with the wider third sector and also with the public sector. So we're very supportive of that approach, but it's also got to come with resources. There's different ways at the moment in which communities are being helped to come up with local community climate action plans, but unless there's actually resources and funding to then implement those plans, then that's very rapidly going to lead to communities becoming disillusioned and disengaged. So I think there needs to be some way found of enabling the climate hubs to then fund and resource projects which are planned in their areas. I don't know if that answers your question, Mark, but that at the moment, that there is a big sort of gap in funding for the next year, which is going to be a real issue for many of our organisations who are going to be shedding staff and losing a lot of expertise and losing a lot of momentum around the projects they're currently running.
Mm. Okay, thanks. Back to you, Convener.
Thank you very much, Mark. Final question from Liam Kerr. Over to you, Liam, please.
Thank you, Convener. I'll be brief. Good afternoon, panel. I'll direct this question just to Mark. And again, Mark, if we can have a brief answer if possible, and the others come in if they have something to add. The heat and building strategy requires homes to be EPCC rated by 2033, and the installation of new or replacement fossil fuel boilers will be phased out after 2025 for off-gas houses and 2030 for on gas. Mark, do you think that communities are aware of these impending deadlines? Is there sufficient support available to them to meet them? And in any event, are communities aware of that support?
I think the answer is no to all of those questions. I think there is there's certainly some of the discussions I've had, and we've been involved with a trust looking to retrofit new boilers into its facility, and it kind of looked at number of technologies, including wood chip, and they decided in the end that actually it wasn't the cost, which was several times the cost of a gas boiler system. The issue was about the wood chips and the deliveries that would be needed on a three-weekly basis, and that disturbing factor to the neighbours. I don't think there is an awareness at all. And I think one of the elements we did have with CCF was an ability to have a conversation about kind of what was going on. And I think this is back to one of my earlier points about there needs to be the kind of dialogue, treat us and residents as adults, so we can have that kind of conversation about what does that look like and how do we make the kind of progress. And new builds are kind of fine, but there's a whole retrofit element that we could actually be very creative in terms of how we link that to the kind of green jobs. But at the moment it just feels like a kind of concept, and it's not linking really into things like No One Left Behind and that change that's coming in employability just literally months from now.
Very grateful. Same question to Philip Revel, please.
Thanks very much for the question. I mean, this is a huge issue, knowing that there is a general lack of awareness at the moment. More to the point, though, there's a lack of anywhere where householders can go for knowledgeable expert advice that they can actually trust. But there are models out there where communities are providing that, and communities are very well placed to do that if they have the resources to do it. I mean, then, one of the best examples, I guess, is in Fife, where there's a Cozy Kingdom project, which is running across the whole of Fife, which does provide tailored expert advice to householders. But then that needs to be linked with then support for householders to actually implement the measures, and the need for skilled local tradespeople who have the knowledge and skills to then go in and implement the measures that are needed to drastically reduce energy consumption, which is really what we need to be focused on. So there's a massive challenge in how we do roll out a retrofit program for the whole of our current housing stock, and communities have a key role to play in that, both in terms of providing the trusted advice, but also in terms of potentially local supporting local enterprises and businesses to actually do the work that's needed.
Very grateful. Back to you, Convener.
Thank you very much. Liam, that brings us to the end of our allocated time. So let me thank our panel members for joining us this morning and for helping us very much understand the views from community groups in respect of the key themes of our inquiry and helping local groups in the transition to net zero. I will now close the public part of this meeting. Thank you.